from Ultra Elite Clubs.
There was a guy who just spent $1.3 million in one evening.
To A-list after parties.
No matter how good a party crasher you are, you will not get access.
And exclusive VIP events.
We have a heavy screening process. You can't just buy a ticket.
Beyond the red carpets and movie sets lies a forbidden Hollywood known only to the rich and famous.
Life for a Hollywood VIP is so different from the normal civilian. They can have anything they want at any time.
But what really goes on behind the scenes?
The Harvey Keitel character you saw in Pulp Fiction, he really exists.
How far will celebrities go to cover up a scandal?
How much money do you want to make this just go away?
And what shocking truths might be exposed when we draw back the curtain and take a glimpse into secret societies of Hollywood. Hollywood, California. For nearly a century, it has been the playground of the rich and famous. But behind the locked doors and security gates is a world known only to a privileged few. A world that those on the inside will do anything to remain a part of.
The creme de la creme of all of Hollywood. They can have anything they want at any time. Kind of things that we are told but can't print would blow your mind. If you're famous, you can get anything.
Ever since the earliest days of Hollywood, members of the entertainment industry elite have had to form secret alliances to remain viable in the world of luxury and privacy they've come to cherish. But what are these secret societies? Who's in them? And what do you have to do to be a member?
When it comes to getting away with things, celebrities get away with, I would say, everything.
Celebrities like to hang out in their kind of secret groups, in their secret clubs.
Being a Hollywood VIP comes with one very important perk. Something only money and fame can buy. VIP access. And nowhere is that more important than at the doors to the city's most exclusive clubs and parties.
The top nightclub VIP rooms are difficult to access. You have to know the right person or be the right person, and that's it. And once you get in there, it's a free-for-all. Celebrities let their hair down, and it's a party.
The VIP rooms in Hollywood now are sort of obsolete in favor of VIP clubs. So you do smaller clubs that cater to the kings and queens of the city. And then within that, you have tables that create the real estate that they even feel more protected.
Dean May and Tony Daly are two of Hollywood's most prominent party promoters. Born and raised in Los Angeles, they've turned their personal relationships with the rich and famous into careers as party promoters for SBE, one of the world's preeminent luxury hospitality enterprises.
Los Angeles is a promoter-driven town. Promoters are the kings of LA, and what good promoters are doing what nights is kind of dictates what goes on.
Party promoters hold the keys to the most exclusive venues in the city.
Back up, guys.
They strive to give their celebrity clients not just a safe haven away from the public and paparazzi, but also a unique experience that'll keep the town's A-listers coming back for more.
One of our venues, the Sayers Club, you actually go through a what used to be a hot dog stand. It's an indiscriminate front entrance, no signs, and you're either in or you're out. There's no line. There is a club on Hollywood Boulevard where they open three different doors and only one door actually opens. Once you get inside, the girl on the bed asks you a question, and if you answer it right, a hydraulic system pulls the bed away with the girl on it, and it reveals the stairs that takes you down into the bar. It's so elitist that we don't even do a red rope. You just don't even know where it is.
The hottest club right now is Beecher's Madhouse in the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel. You enter through a bookcase, and once inside, It is like a circus. There are little people working as bartenders. There are burlesque dancers. There are transvestites. I mean, it is a madhouse, and celebrities love it.
You're never quite sure what's going to take place inside there. Miley Cyrus loves to party there. It's become a place where every A-lister likes to go.
Paris, up here, baby. Come on.
I would say that the hardest consistent door to get into in Los Angeles is Greystone Manor. It's probably in 15 rap songs right now. It's got a Sunday night hip hop party that people literally come to Los Angeles for.
Of course, for some celebrities, the best way to make sure a club meets your expectations is to run your own. Stars like Charlie Sheen, Jay-Z, and Shaquille O'Neal have invested big money in VIP venues where they can party hard with their very own inner circle. And all away from the prying eyes and cameras of the paparazzi.
Tootsie Bellows has become a really big place for especially young Hollywood. It's owned by David Arquette and John Terzian. And what happens inside that club doesn't get out. So celebrities know that they can go there, they can party, they can dance. Selena Gomez famously went to Tootsie Bellows for her 21st birthday.
Those who manage to get past security at these Hollywood hotspots enter a world where celebrities and their pals can behave as they please. There's no holds barred.
They'll have these buffets where you have this beautiful woman or beautiful man laying on a table just covered in sushi. And everyone will come up, and I've watched this. It's just take the food off them, and you slowly reveal each part of their body as you eat this amazing sushi. It's amazing.
Of course, it should come as no surprise that in a world where money talks, the one who spends the most talks the loudest.
There was a guy who just spent $1.3 million in one evening buying 15 liters of Ace Rosé at over $100,000 a bottle. You'll see guys come in and there'll be five of them and they'll order 50 bottles of Cristal. And then before you know it, everybody's carefree because this guy's paying for everything. And, you know, you try and drink the whole 50 bottles.
It makes for an amazing night when those guys come in. It's a lot of fun.
Sure, these nightclubs are wild and crazy, but believe it or not, they're just a warm-up for what goes on at the even more exclusive after-parties.
What people don't know about Hollywood is, even though the bars shut at 2, that's when things get going and you go to the private house parties.
It's like a high-end frat party at some $10 million mansion.
Yeah. After-hours house parties, you're more likely to see celebrities than you would inside the nightclub because it's more sheltered, and in the club, different people can get in. At house parties, it's way more controlled and there's more security.
No matter how good a party crasher you are, you will not get access.
In a town like this, the real power brokers aren't the studio chiefs. They're the party promoters, the bouncers, and the bodyguards. They're the gatekeepers who decide who gets in and who gets close. They also do whatever it takes to ensure that what happens at the party stays at the party.
In fact, they confiscate your cell phone and they run a metal detector over you to make sure that you don't have any other things that they missed. They also take the batteries out of the cell phones just in case you manage to grab it.
They'll even sometimes have people sign NDA, so non-disclosure confidentiality agreements, so that if somebody does speak about their night with Justin Bieber or whatever it might be, that they could actually get sued.
Located just 24 miles northwest of Hollywood, the gated hilltop community of Calabasas boasts A-list residents like Jennifer Lopez, Drake, and the Kardashians. It's also home to the most infamous event in town, Justin Bieber's Wild Kids Parties.
Justin Bieber is known for having quite wild parties, and we know this actually because some of his neighbors have spoken. They've been very angry about the noise and the loud music and the driving of the fast cars in the neighborhood.
Now, he didn't always make people sign non-disclosure agreements, so we do know what happens in some of his parties. It's one guy for four or five girls. Now, what Justin would do is he would go up to the girls, and he'd ask them three or four or five questions. And if they gave the right kind of answer that Justin was looking for, then he would take them back into a bedroom. It's generally different women every single night. And these parties are becoming legendary, and they are definitely an exclusive ticket, but maybe not a ticket that you want your daughter to go to.
But whether it's a secret nightclub, a VIP room, or even a private house party, once a hotspot loses its cool factor, there's always another ultra-decadent destination ready to take its place.
There's so many parties in Hollywood that you can't talk about. Every night, there's secret things happening all over the place that if you discuss, then you'd never be able to go to again, and you wouldn't be knowing about them.
Coming up.
One thing that a convention always needs, hookers. And Cannes provides the very, very best.
Whether it's bondage and discipline or dressing the celebrity up like a baby and, you know, putting a pacifier in its mouth and changing his diapers, you can get that in Hollywood as long as you can pay for it, and it doesn't come cheap.
Hollywood is no stranger to scandal. And when it comes to media coverage, the sexier the scandal, the better. But whether it's a leaked sex tape or an actor coming out of the closet, there's much more going on under the Hollywood covers and within Hollywood's secret societies than the public knows.
I've heard some crazy stories over the years about what really happens at these private parties, from wife swapping, swinger parties, just nakedness, a ton of drugs. There's one particular starlet, very young in Hollywood at the moment, that apparently walks around her parties naked.
Some of these parties become very erotic. We walk into this beautiful ambiance of Eyes Wide Shut masquerade, and everyone's kind of anonymous. And as they loosen up through the evening, they become less anonymous, and people make new friends. The experience is very kind of Cirque meets 50 Shades.
Heidi Fleiss, aka the Hollywood Madam, became a celebrity herself when it was revealed she had been supplying prostitutes for an elite clientele, including everyone's favorite bad boy, Charlie Sheen.
The sex parties that have existed in Hollywood for years, if not decades, are stuff of legend. There was a Chinese guy, I won't mention his name, let's just call him AC. AC used to run a weekly party, and people would show up in their Mercedes and their Bentleys, and it was like you had a harem. Mostly strippers and porn stars. They mingled with you while you were having your drinks, and then you'd see people couple off and move into various rooms in the mansion, and it was wholesale prostitution.
More recently, Michelle Braun ran Nikki's Girls, an online brothel, arranging introductions between ultra-rich men and everyone from Playboy models and actresses to beauty queens.
Michelle Braun got started in the business because she was at a party. This dot-com millionaire said, you know what I'd really like to do? I'd really, really like to have sex with a Playboy playmate. She called up one of her friends who was a playmate and said, there's this guy who's willing to pay you $50,000 for sex. The woman said, I'm in. So Michelle went back to the guy and said, she's willing to do it, but it's going to cost you $250,000. Michelle Braun made $200,000 that night and was hooked.
She was very much a Hollywood player and had a great business sense. Rich guys have needs, and she filled it.
She was allegedly supplying girls to everyone from Tiger Woods down in Florida to anybody here that wanted a specific playmate, a specific porn star, or just someone, you know, that they picked off her catalog on the internet. So ultimately, she got busted for transporting women across state lines for purposes of prostitution. And she got caught up in a sting in Orange County by the feds.
For Hollywood's top players, the ability to get sex on demand isn't restricted to the town's sun-drenched city limits. For 12 days each May, anybody who's anybody relocates to southern France for the Cannes International Film Festival. But when the festival is in town, Cannes also becomes a hotspot for people selling something other than movies.
As business becomes more global, one of those businesses that's going global is prostitution. And Cannes provides the very, very best. Yachts offshore, 200, 300 foot yachts. Each one, minimum of 20 women. Each one of those women getting paid anywhere between $5,000 and $40,000 a night. Now, if you're an actress and you made $40,000 the year before, but 3 years earlier, you made $2 million. You probably still have a $2 million lifestyle. You also probably have a face that people recognize. Maybe times are tough. Maybe you go to Cannes. They're not giving $40,000 a night to somebody that came off the streets of Nice. They're giving $40,000 a night to somebody they saw on a movie screen.
Thanks, guys. Thanks.
Of course, while some Hollywood hotshots choose to keep their illicit liaisons private, others satisfy their carnal appetites by attending underground orgies that cater to everything from swinging to sex slaves. But even here, at clubs like Sanctum, you have to be a part of the secret VIP society to gain entrance.
You can't just buy a ticket like going to Burning Man. They will decide who's allowed to come to their parties, and the ticket price does weed out anyone who may not be appropriate for the party.
I believe that Sanctum is the most secret society. It's so different from a normal party or a club. It's definitely a taboo. If you want to have sex in any room, you may, because that's what it is. It's a sex party. It's really an exciting and different kind of feeling, because you even get to smell the sex in the air, opposed to just sitting at home and watching porn.
There are dungeons where these dominatrixes are legally, you know, beating the hell out of these entertainment executives and or actors and even actresses, you know, who are into that sort of things. I know a lot of dominatrix who are making enviable amounts of money doing it.
There's definitely been simulated, you know, shows going on. I once saw one where Marie Antoinette herself was there, and she and her pony were having a great time together, and I thought, now that's a party.
It's whether it's bondage and discipline or, you know, infantilism, dressing the celebrity up like a baby and, you know, putting a pacifier in its mouth and changing his diapers. You can get that in Hollywood as long as you can pay for it, and it doesn't come cheap.
For the Hollywood elite, nothing is out of bounds or out of reach. And A-list access extends well beyond wild parties and secret sex clubs. For the rich and famous, everything from shopping to eating dinner is done VIP style. Coming up.
Celebrities are going to these private recovery centers where, under a different name, they're being taken care of by people who agree never to speak of it.
There's different rules for celebrities than there are for the rest of the world. Juries don't convict celebrities.
You can go anywhere you want. You can get in anywhere you want. I'm not gonna bitch. It's amazing life.
First, it was the gold card. Then it was the platinum. Now, it's the black card that really measures your street cred in the real world. But for Hollywood A-listers, their face and their fame is their fortune. That is, while it lasts.
Life for a Hollywood VIP is so different from the normal civilians. People just won't say no to them. If they want front row tickets to any sporting game, any music event, any film, if they want to go to a shop when it's in the middle of the night and wouldn't normally open, those kind of things are accessible to celebrities.
You can go anywhere you want. You can get in anywhere you want. It is a different world when you become a celebrity. I'm not gonna bitch, it's amazing life.
For Hollywood's heaviest hitters, the VIP treatment extends to every aspect of their lives. When flying into Los Angeles, a true celeb makes the scene in a private plane, and waiting to pick them up is the real super shuttle.
There is a certain phone number that you call when you come into town. And when you call that number, arriving to pick you up at your private jet at Santa Monica Airport is a stretch limo driven by a very attractive woman. And inside that limo is every single narcotic or vice you could want. And it's there for your beck and call. You just have to know who to call. And that number just doesn't go out to, you know, anybody.
And if you thought you'd catch a glimpse of J-Lo shopping for munchies at the local supermarket, forget it.
Hollywood VIPs definitely do not shop like regular citizens. For the right VIP, I can close stores. Stores usually get closed down when it's such a big customer that they have no other reason to stay open. They'll make more money on this one customer alone than they would all day with pedestrian shopping for a scarf or perfume.
But for Hollywood VIPs, the most important access is to other celebrities. And where better to rub shoulders with your fellow members of the rich and famous than at places like West LA's Equinox Fitness Club, where superstars from movies, TV, and music suit up to get all up close and sweaty on the basketball court. It's called the E-League, a secret club that holds weekly closed-door matchups, and it's masterminded by film producer and former NBA marketing guru, Shane Duffy.
He decided that he wanted to get the best players he could to play in the league. All celebrities, but they had to be good. So he has a personal tryout for every celebrity. Snoop Dogg had to try out. Frankie Munoz had to try out. Justin Timberlake had to try out. And this league pits all these celebrities against each other.
And when E-leaguers like Leonardo DiCaprio, Adam Sandler, Ice Cube, and Will Ferrell leave the court to grab a bite, they do it Hollywood style. No reservations required.
What you don't know is that there's always a table kept vacant in the top Hollywood establishments, just in case Justin Bieber or another A-list star wants to come in right at the last moment.
VIP tables are for a certain level of VIP. And then there's like another level of VIP. There's like the table that's like, you want everybody that walks into that restaurant to see you sitting there. Because you want everyone to walk and be like, oh, dude. It's that other table that's like way over there in the back in the corner where no one can really see, where the lights are a little dimmer. Those are the real VIPs. Right now in LA, the hardest table to get is at Urasawa. It's like 10 seats. Very delicate, beautiful things, and very artistic with their taste and their smell and the texture. And it's about $500 a person. It's worth it.
Of course, if you're really an A-lister, you need to do more than just spend your way to the top. You need to be invited. And for the right price, you can join one of the town's ultra-private, members-only clubs, like Soho House, hidden in plain sight on top of this 14-story building on Sunset Boulevard.
It's the one place where celebrities actually feel safe. Soho has initiation fees, annual membership fees. There's applications to fill out, and you have to know somebody. You can't just go up and knock on the door and say, I'd like to go to Soho.
But believe it or not, the real Hollywood E-ticket, as far as private clubs go, can be found at the very place where the E-ticket was invented. That's right, Disneyland. Because for Hollywood celebrities, Club 33 really is the happiest place on Earth.
Club 33 is a very, very private members club that's part of Disneyland. It's the kind of place Tom Hanks goes, Jack Nicholson goes, Vanessa Hudgens recently went. Even if you're a celebrity, you need serious cash to be able to go here. It's a $25,000 initiation fee, and then it's $10,000 every single year.
In Hollywood, even more important than how much money you have is who you know. Several nights every summer, a select few are invited to a secret location just west of downtown LA in Hancock Park. At a 100-year-old mansion, the chosen ones drink and mingle in a secluded garden, waiting to experience a show most in Hollywood have never even heard of. But this ultra-exclusive venue is not what you might expect. It's run by magicians, the only people more secretive than celebrities. Originally opened in 1933, Brookledge was a favorite hangout of Houdini and Orson Welles, and is the precursor to Hollywood's world-famous Magic Castle, where only members and their guests are allowed in.
The Magic Castle is the most unusual club in Hollywood. And they actually have secret rooms. It's very difficult to find out information about what's going on inside.
In 2009, the owners of the Magic Castle upped the ultra-exclusive ante when they reopened Brookledge, which has been closed since the castle opened in 1963. And no cameras have ever been allowed through the gates until now.
Let's go stepping 2-6.
sinister happens tonight.
What they allowed to be filmed reveals a mashup of music, magic, and the bizarre.
I've seen everything here from prestidigitation to performance art to literally life-endangering tricks.
But most in Hollywood will never see what goes on at the Brookledge Follies because it's strictly invite-only.
If you don't know someone who knows someone, there's no way you would hear about it or get in.
There's a lot of secret Hollywoods, and this is definitely one of them.
From invite-only parties to secret celebrity sports leagues and member-only clubs, the Hollywood in-crowd lead the type of lives most people can only dream of. But when celebrities don't want their private activities ending up public knowledge, how do they keep it all under wraps? In Hollywood, there's one important rule to live by. Keep your friends close and your assistants closer. Coming up.
It's like running away to join the circus, but then discovering that when nobody's looking, the animals do unspeakable things to each other.
Hollywood fixers, they're human garbage men, and they clean up the messes that celebrities and power brokers leave in their wake.
In Hollywood, a celebrity's closest allies aren't their friends, managers, or agents. It's their personal assistants. Why?
Hi, Beyonce.
Because no one has more dirt on the stars than the people hired to do their dirty work. And one of their jobs is to keep their mouth shut.
Personal assistants have actually peed in cups for the celebrities so that if they're having a drug test, the celebrity comes across as clean.
In many celebrities' lives, there is the public persona they put out, and then there's the secret life that they want to protect. So they make sure that anyone that they do allow into this secret world, they can control.
Having intimate knowledge of a celebrity's life makes personal assistants a secret society within a secret society. It's a tight-knit community fueled by loyalty and discretion.
A celebrity assistant may be the one who, if there's going to be a raid, disposes of the drugs. They are asked to maybe drive after an accident, pretend they were driving when the celebrity was driving.
When you become an assistant to a celebrity or a Tinseltown bigwig, it's like running away to join the circus, but then discovering that when nobody's looking, the animals do unspeakable things to each other and to themselves. The draw really is a ground-level opportunity to rocket yourself into a gated community of actors and executives and creators in general. The secret to getting a job as an assistant is that you have to know somebody. The savvy assistants, they leapfrog to better positions. So once you are in the club, your network of assistants are the same people that you're going to go up through the ranks with.
In Hollywood, personal assistants handle nearly every aspect of their employers' lives, giving them access to social security numbers, bank accounts, family secrets, health records, and other intimate personal details. It's a risky business entrusting so much to one person, and if it doesn't work out, sometimes it's the boss who stands to lose the most.
Ricky Lake talked about delivering her infant son at home via water birth. And then she had asked her assistant to clean the tub afterwards. And you know that's an assistant you can trust because that placenta did not end up on eBay.
All right, thank you very much.
Nearly as close as personal assistants, but also literally in the line of fire, are the stars' bodyguards. But in addition to shielding their clients and their families from physical harm, they also guard them from the prying eyes and cameras of the paparazzi.
For some celebrities, going out and partying is as secure as what I would imagine that the president would have. And sometimes what they get up to, if that ever came out, it could actually ruin a career.
Some, shall we say, overzealous bodyguards have even been sued while in the employ of megastars like Justin Bieber. Britney Spears, and Leonardo DiCaprio. But what are these bodyguards so aggressively trying to hide? And why are so many of these celebrity-related lawsuits suddenly and mysteriously dropped? That's where the person known as the Fixer comes in.
Hollywood Fixers, they're human garbage men, and they clean up the messes that celebrities and power brokers leave in their wake. Hollywood Fixers go back to the Golden Age. These are shady gumshoe types, not unlike myself, who know how to assess a situation when there's a problem, when irreparable damage can be caused to the celebrity who's involved in something shady, and these are the guys who make the problems go away, hence the name Fixers.
Hollywood Fixers do exist, and I happen to be one of them. I think probably one of the more infamous ones would be Anthony Pellicano. Anthony was great at what he did.
The Harvey Keitel character you saw in Pulp Fiction, he really exists. He's not going to help you maybe dispose of a murdered body, although back in the 50s and 60s during the studio system, he probably would have. Now the Fixers are generally called crisis managers. They handle clients who are in big, big trouble. They've handled Michael Vick. They've handled R. Kelly.
Usually, that big, big trouble involves another person. Maybe the victim of a star's temper tantrum, a battered lover, or someone with incriminating information or photos.
Sometimes the injured parties can be convinced not to go forward. And if you don't have an injured party going forward or somebody who wants to cooperate with the investigation, you have nothing. You just want to find out how much money do you want to make this go away. And you'd be surprised. Greed is good.
But there are some problems even a fixer can't fix, and where bodyguards and personal assistants can only go so far. What happens when a Hollywood VIP's worst enemy is himself? Coming up.
In Hollywood, the VIPs, quite often, their drug dealers are actual physicians.
I'm shocked at the life that these people live behind these gates.
For those living in the Hollywood fast lane, designer drugs are as common a party favor as chips and dip. Many of the most exclusive VIP events have a Willy Wonka-like selection of uppers and downers available right from the bar. And the hot new drink is a codeine concoction that goes by the names Scissor, Purple Drink, and most appropriately, Lean.
Lean, they call it lean because it makes you go like this. It's a cough medicine with codeine mixed with some sort of purple soda. They drink this stuff like soda pop all day long, and by the end of the day, you're leaning to the point where you're falling flat on your face.
It may come as no surprise that in La La Land, drugs are rampant. But according to those on the inside, there's a secret network of drug users within the Hollywood community, and the public has no idea just how wild the party can really get.
It happens in the bathroom, it happens in the back bedroom, because you never know who's gonna see it and judge it. So there is sort of a secret society of people who know that they all do hard drugs, and it's sort of a nod and a let's go over there.
The drugs are either designer drugs like ecstasy, ketamine, OxyContin, narcotics, painkillers are really popular in Hollywood and really addictive.
That's right. The hottest drugs in Hollywood are legal, with a prescription, that is. And in this town, even more valuable than the celebrity's autograph is their doctors.
In Hollywood, the VIPs, quite often, their drug dealers are actual physicians, the legendary Dr. Feelgoods. These are doctors who have a small handful of very wealthy clients, and they're making $1 million a year peddling drugs.
A lot of celebrities maintain this perfect aura by relying on the help of drugs. There are drugs that help them get skinny. There are drugs that help them look more youthful. There are drugs that give them energy to help them keep going on their long hours and party into the wee hours of the morning.
Today, prescription drugs are more popular than ever, thanks in part to the fact that the only thing more addictive than drugs is celebrity.
I'm trying to show the world inside of me, that's all.
There are doctors out there that will see 100 patients a day, and they'll charge $100 So they're making $10,000 a day, 5 days a week. And what they're doing is they're just writing out prescriptions for pills. Doctors will take pictures of celebrities and hang them on their wall. And so when other patients come in, they see the celebrity and they go, oh my goodness, this must be the best doctor ever.
While scripts are more in vogue than ever, illegal narcotics are just as popular among the Hollywood elite and just as easy to score.
So what you have in Hollywood, you have a lot of middlemen. It's not middlemen trying to make money. What they're trying to do is be friends with a celebrity. Being around a celebrity is addictive. They want to go to the great clubs. They want to ride on a private jet. They want to ride in limos. Celebrities then stay insulated.
When you've got a person who may be calling the shots for hundreds of people, they get away with murder.
But could it be more than just the baller lifestyle and unlimited access that's behind the widespread drug use in Hollywood? Some believe the very traits that drive a person to be famous also leave them more susceptible to becoming addicted to hardcore drugs.
There's kind of been studies about it, actually, that there's a certain type of personality that wants to become famous. And it's a very similar kind of personality to people who do have that kind of addictive gene.
When Tom Sizemore was doing Natural Born Killers, there was a scene where he had to snort cocaine, and he went and asked a grip and said, get me real cocaine, because that's what I need to do, and that's what happened.
Drugs always have been, and probably always will be, part of the Hollywood culture. But like most things in this town, the reality is never as glamorous as what you see on the screen.
I think people have these ideas that celebrities, you know, they're living the life, they have all this money and just cocaine and whatever they want. Well, actually, doing cocaine is one of the loneliest things you can possibly do in the world. And addiction is masking terrible pain and trauma and sadness.
When you drive by Forest Lawn, that beautiful white mansion, the beautiful lawns, the fountain, behind the scenes, it's like a slaughterhouse. Hollywood is no different. The red carpet, the big smiles, the limos, the flashing lights, the nicely dressed celebrities. And how many times have you watched that? And then days or weeks or a month later, the individual's dead, died of an overdose. I'm shocked at the life that these people live behind these gates.
Sooner or later, most drug addicts end up behind bars. But when you're among the Hollywood elite, a dangerous meth habit is more likely to land you in a Malibu mansion. Coming up.
Rehab is probably one of the biggest scams going.
Look, I get art therapy, I get horse therapy. I don't get combining the two.
In Hollywood, drugs are so much a part of the culture that most heavy hitters will take a bump with as little fear of the law as a jaywalker.
There's just tons of people who are ready to give you what you want. It's nuts.
But even A-list addicts eventually have to face the music. Only for them, it's a much different tune.
The bottom line is when you're wealthy and you have a certain amount of fame to your name, you tend to get away with a lot of stuff.
When celebrities hit rock bottom, high-end rehabs are there to help them pick up the pieces. While the Betty Ford Clinic used to be the hot ticket for celebrity rehab, it pales in comparison to the newer luxury treatment centers catering to the stars.
2 years ago, we thought $30,000 a month was a lot to pay for a month-long stay in a rehab. Now we've got recovery centers that are charging up to six figures, $96,000, $100,000 a month. There's no secret why the rehab and recovery industry in and around Hollywood is probably a $25 billion a year industry.
There are treatment centers that are $95,000 a month where you're kind of allowed to do whatever you want. They also have 500 thread count sheets and suits and all these sort of luxury amenities.
A lot of them are strategically placed on cliffs overlooking the Pacific Ocean. They call themselves recovery centers, coddling and nurturing and feeding and offering all kinds of distractions by way of movie nights and haute cuisine and field trips and surf lessons and things as absurd as, believe it or not, equine therapy.
There are ridiculous things that people do. There was a rehab that was doing horse painting, where you take a horse
and you paint, and you paint on it. Look, I get art therapy, I get horse therapy. I don't get combining the two. There was a doctor that was detoxing celebrities for 10 grand a day at a Beverly Hills hotel. He would detox you.
There was a big, big celebrity who I was told was going into rehab in that person's own home. And that was how they were keeping it private. And I remember the celebrity actually calling me from their house and saying, I'm not in rehab. And I was like, I know, you're doing it at your house.
There are a lot of quick fixes that money can buy, you know, to allegedly help an addict get through the withdrawal process. There's a lot of folklore about literally some celebrities having, you know, their blood drained and replaced. There are expensive drugs that they can replace the drugs that you've been putting in your body, and things that can lessen the horrible sort of suffering that comes along with drug and alcohol withdrawal.
But is rehabilitation from a hardcore drug problem really possible while sitting in the lap of luxury?
The nature of addiction is, sooner or later, you have to, quote unquote, hit your bottom. And that means whether it takes you literally to Skid Row or the Skid Row is a state of mind, you need to be down and out in order to look up and get better. Well, they do everything possible not to let you reach that bottom that is necessary.
Rehab is probably one of the biggest scams going. If it's not done right, it's not gonna work. And right is making sure that you get medical treatment, that you're hospitalized in a real hospital, and you get real treatment. And if you're real successful at failing at rehab, you end up dead. And I think that list is a big list in this town.
The best secret to getting sober is unfortunate for celebrities because it's finding humility and it's sort of really believing and accepting you are just the same as everybody else, which is such a challenge for celebrities when you've got the whole world treating you like you're better than everyone else.
The real question is, how are you gonna stay stopped? This calls for a fundamental change in you. And if that change doesn't come about as soon as you get clean, you know, the first call you're gonna make after you call your agent is to call your drug dealer.
But although rehab in Hollywood is more caviar than cold turkey, some celebrities do find a way to get clean. And often through the counsel of another celebrity.
I remember with Tom Sizemore, what his family did is they got Robert De Niro, who is his idol, to come to the intervention. And that's gonna work. Matthew Perry is an amazing example of somebody who very publicly suffered with addiction. But when he finally got sober, I think that he became determined to sort of try to change the face of what addiction is. He took this beautiful house that he has in Malibu and turned it into a sober living house.
For most who've had a taste of the rock star lifestyle, it doesn't take much to veer off the straight and narrow. And for the Hollywood elite, when all the hard living catches up with them, their VIP access extends to the doctor's office as well. Coming up.
Human growth hormone, testosterone, estrogen treatments. These things are used by a huge percentage of people in Hollywood.
People would be surprised if they knew the number of things people in Hollywood do to sort of look a certain way.
In LA, you can party like a rock star, pop pills like candy, and even do a couple of stints in rehab. But one thing you can't do is let it take a toll on your looks. How do Hollywood VIPs manage to live life in the fast lane without showing the mileage? And what secret societies exist to keep the beautiful people looking beautiful?
I think people would be surprised if they knew the number of things people in Hollywood do to sort of look a certain way.
When people become famous, I immediately notice that they lose weight and their hair gets blonder. Their teeth get whiter, and then they get capped, and then their wrinkles start to disappear, and then their nose becomes thinner, and then their chin becomes a little more defined, and then their breasts become larger.
In Hollywood, you basically bring two things to the table, talent and your looks. Your talent perseveres, but if your looks don't, you're out.
Shrouded in a veil of secrecy, the world's top health and beauty gurus are called in when a celebrity is preparing for a role, walking the red carpet, or just undergoing some regularly scheduled maintenance. first line of defense against Father Time is Hollywood's Barbell Brain Trust, the top personal trainers in the industry who train their clients either at their homes or at ultra-high-tech underground gyms.
There definitely are ultra-exclusive gyms. I mean, Hollywood's all about being a VIP, being ultra-exclusive.
Tucked away in a Beverly Hills alley is the entrance to a top-secret facility where A-list names like Affleck, Perry, and Messing sneak in to work out. In-demand celebrity trainer Adam Ernster built the aptly named Bunker Gym, complete with high-tech biometric access, so his clients would have a private place to break a sweat.
The Bunker in Beverly Hills is an ultra-exclusive, invitation-only gym. It has a paparazzi-proof garage and is very difficult to get into. Inside, it has state-of-the-art equipment and amazing instructors.
While it might be uncool to pant in public, you have to wonder if there's another reason VIPs prefer to get fit under top security.
They just look better than everybody else. I always say that Hollywood celebrities are like humans on steroids.
But some celebrities don't just look like humans on steroids. Every year, more and more athletes are getting exposed for steroid use. But it's not just sports stars that feel the need to juice. When an actor has to get ripped in a hurry, there's no better way to prepare for a performance than with performance-enhancing drugs.
One story that I think is a big one in Hollywood that people are reluctant to talk about is how actors transform their bodies for roles. We often hear about people going to trainers and following a particular diet, and it's true, they do all that. But there are some other things people do to become a big giant superhero or whatever they're playing that would surprise people.
Everyone's looking for that quick fix. And for celebrities, it's their job to stay fit, to look good, to be at their peak all the time. So they're trying to lead superhero lives.
And it's not just steroids that actors are injecting to preserve their youth.
Hollywood is very into hormone treatments, injections to keep your skin looking amazing, to keep your body fat down, to allow you to get ripped. People would be shocked if they knew how common it was for people to use hormone replacement therapy, human growth hormone, testosterone, estrogen treatments. These things are used by a huge percentage of people in Hollywood, not particularly legal, but they're very effective in keeping you strong and youthful looking.
But sometimes even drugs aren't enough to keep an A-lister looking up to snuff. That's when they resort to more drastic measures. Going under the knife has become Hollywood's bottomless fountain of youth.
Hollywood is the plastic surgery center of the universe.
Whether it's HGH or Botox, they're all doing something. Breast lifts, facelifts, nose jobs, eye lifts, lip injections. It goes on and on and on. They've all done something. Plastic surgery is something that they don't want to admit. Plastic surgery would show that they're not the most beautiful person on the planet, that they needed some kind of little extra boost to make them like that.
In Hollywood, men are much more secretive about plastic surgery than women, and men do very different procedures than women. Men do, of course, hair transplants, a lot of upper eyelid surgery, some facelift surgery, and a lot of liposuction, whereas women, it basically runs the gamut. Men won't tell you about it at all. Whereas women are willing to come forward and say, yeah, I had a little nip and tuck.
These days, a little nip and tuck doesn't necessarily involve a knife. The Hollywood A-list is known for being first to jump on the experimental treatment bandwagon, hoping to find the latest and greatest quick fix.
I have heard from a esthetician friend of mine that celebrities are putting stem cells on their face to look younger, which is basically the umbilical cord of babies on their face. So that's a new one. I don't think I would go that far.
The big thing in Hollywood right now are the non-invasive things. The laser treatments, the thermages, the ultrasounds, the heating up of the skin to prevent it from becoming lax and dropping. Another thing we do is freeze fat. If you've got a little excess fat in certain areas that's diet resistant, we can freeze it externally and the cells die and you basically just urinate them out. Vaginal rejuvenation refers to a number of procedures you do down there. Reducing what's called the labia minora is really hot in Hollywood right now.
But no matter what or where they nip and tuck, if a celebrity hopes to keep their secret enhancement secret, they heal up away from the prying eyes of the paparazzi at recovery centers designed to look more like luxury condos.
Celebrities are not going into any hospitals. They're going to these private recovery centers where, under a different name, they're being taken care of by people who sign non-disclosure agreements who agree never to speak of it.
There is a recovery center so exclusive that they only allow 3 patients at a time. 3. That's it. Each one is charged $100,000 for 1 month. That is the most exclusive recovery center that there is. Most of the recovery centers are way nicer than any vacation that you and I will ever take.
The rich and famous will go to any length to preserve their beauty and to keep the public from knowing about it. But no matter how many precautions celebrities take to ensure that their private lives stay private, in the internet age, it's impossible to keep everything hidden. Of course, for the rich and famous, there's almost no crisis their people can't manage. Coming up.
There are people paid every day to stop things from going in tabloids.
I've never felt that the playing field of the criminal justice system is fair and flat. It's flat and fair for some people, but it's very hilly with some big pits for a lot of others.
Welcome back to New York.
From bodyguards to fixers to plastic surgeons, the biggest Hollywood celebs employ an impressive entourage to keep their image intact. But living large can lead to superstar-sized problems. And when that happens, it's time to call in the crisis management team. In the face of this secret society is the publicist.
We sort of get blamed for everything that goes wrong in a celebrity's career. And then you cross into the realm of damage control PR and scandals and who did your client sleep with and are they breaking up a marriage and did they have a DUI yesterday? We're sort of like a parent, an assistant, a therapist, a bail bondsman. It's crazy how much goes on and then we don't get enough credit from our clients.
There are people paid every day to stop things from going in tabloids, the media, so that they shut it down real quick.
Damage control has been essential to celebrities since the golden age of Hollywood, long before the time of Lindsay, Britney, and Paris.
They were called flaks back in the day. You wear a flak jacket when you're in combat to shield you from bullets and shrapnel hitting you, and they used their publicists to kind of protect them from anything negative sort of flying at them.
Publicists work in cahoots with their extensive Hollywood network to limit the damage from public scandal. But once legal repercussions are looming, it's time to bring out the big guns. Hollywood power players have their pick of the world's best lawyers. Lucky for them, the most ruthless ones live in L.A. Attorneys like Mark Garagos and Marty Mad Dog Singer have saved scores of celebrities from prison. Just ask Chris Brown.
Chris Brown really owes a lot to his attorney, Mark Garagos, who was able to take a really horrible situation. We all saw those pictures of Rihanna's face badly beaten, and he kept him undercover for a while so people could kind of forget what happened. He brought out the story of Chris Brown and his problems, and then he had Chris really focus on his talent so people could remember what they loved about Chris Brown in the first place.
A few years later, Chris Brown's a star again. And it has a lot to do with Mark Garagos. You'll see him on Larry King. He knows how to handle the media. He's very, very good at what he does. And he managed to restore the reputation of somebody that everybody in America literally hated.
Garagos got Chris Brown 5 years probation. He helped get Michael Jackson acquitted. and got Winona Ryder wrist slapped with a fine, community service, and counseling.
Some of the secrets the celebrity lawyers use with their clients to help project this innocent appearance, they tell them how to dress, put the sweet little sweater on, wear your hair pulled back, minimal makeup, look down when you're in court, look sorry, say yes ma'am, no ma'am, don't smile too much.
There's different rules for celebrities than there are for the rest of the world. Juries don't convict celebrities. And it's not so much that the prosecutors are afraid of them, it's that they know that the jury of the peers are never ever going to convict them. So they just choose to offer up some kind of plea deal.
The hardest thing about a celebrity trial is what I call the celebrity phenomenon. Rather than just judging them on the crime they committed, they're looking at their movie history or their athletic ability, and they already have this halo effect. I remember I was in the courtroom when O.J. Simpson walked in. I knew that he was guilty, and yet you felt that presence. He walked in with that suit that was cut beautifully, and every woman and man sat there and their jaw dropped because he just had that presence.
But might some of Hollywood's most powerful attorneys also engage in shady dealings to protect their troubled VIP clientele?
I've seen them do things that would, in any other town, would get them disbarred in a hot minute. Things like suborning perjury, getting people who have said something in depositions about a celebrity to change their testimony. That's illegal, but in Hollywood, it's like there are no laws. The rules do not apply.
Some celebrities even have access to a special kind of expert most people don't even know exists. Wendy Feldman is a member of a secret society of professionals known as alternative sentencing consultants. When attorneys get stars out of trouble, she helps them stay out of trouble.
They'll be called in to coach somebody out of legal trouble or from creating more legal trouble. And I call that an incarcervention. And that's a word I trademarked, and it really just means a legal intervention. Whether today it's a DUI and tomorrow it's shoplifting, and then the next day it's tax fraud. Celebrities have a habit of pushing the limits, and their entitlement makes that even harder because they're used to getting away with things. I had a case last year with a very major celebrity. She was charged with something that she shouldn't have been charged with, and we got the charge dropped. But had she not had the resources to get together the right team, she'd be sitting in jail right now.
If the public knew what some of their favorite actors were like in real life, they would not want to ever turn their movies on again.
I've never felt that the playing field of the criminal justice system is fair and flat. It's flat and fair for some people, but it's very hilly with some big pits for a lot of others.
A celebrity who's in trouble will do almost anything to stay out of the news. But perhaps even more surprising is how often the bad press is all part of the plan. Coming up.
I don't know what some of these people get paid to crash some of these expensive cars, but the more accidents a celebrity can have in a Bentley, the better it is for that brand to see, look, celebrity so-and-so, they wrecked one of our cars.
People would actually be shocked at what lengths celebrities go to stay in the news.
On July 25th, 2012, Lindsay Lohan made international headlines when she rear-ended a Mustang with her Porsche Panamera. Although there's no reason to believe this wasn't a legitimate fender bender, rumors abound that some Hollywood stars have purposely staged accidents as part of a highly secretive but very lucrative practice called celebrity product placement.
Big smile, good.
I don't know what some of these people get paid to crash some of these expensive cars. The more accidents a celebrity can have in a Bentley, the better it is for that brand to see, look, celebrity so-and-so wrecked one of our cars. They don't care, as long as the name is out there. It's all about the money, and it's all about the attention you can bring to a subject. And that's what a PR person does, either bringing attention to the subject or diverting attention from the subject.
You see pictures on Getty and Wire Image or Us Weekly or whatever, and very often you'll see a really big actor at the opening of a clothing store or something, and you think, why would he be there? Well, he was probably paid $30,000 and the publicists are negotiating that. I've never personally taken money from that, but there are a lot out there that take cuts out of it or whatever it is.
PR people are seen escorting their clients down the red carpet and talking to the press. But behind the scenes, the Hollywood publicity machine is a powerful force capable of manipulating the media itself.
The sexiest man alive, it's not a vote. It's not a bunch of editors sitting around deciding who's the sexiest person. It doesn't matter who is actually the sexiest man alive. It matters who has the best publicist. And that's something people need to realize. They're not always getting the truth, the real truth.
Celebrities are well aware of just how far their fame can get them. And an important rule to live by is always stay in the spotlight. As they say, there's no such thing as bad press. And most people outside of Hollywood might be shocked to discover how often stars get caught on camera on purpose.
They're their own tip sheet. And the reason that they might tip themselves out to the public is it gets really scary for a celebrity to not be in the limelight. So you might call the media and tip them off, or you might tell your friend to call the media and tip them off. More often than not, sources at rehabs or sources in jail on celebrities are created by the celebrity themselves.
Every once in a while, you'll see a celebrity play out their dirty laundry to the press at a nightclub. You'll see somebody in a tumultuous relationship show up at your club and leave out the front door when normally they want to leave out the back door. And then the next day you'll see in TMZ or on E, this so-and-so is spotted with a mystery blonde, and then they got a picture of the ex-boyfriend getting mad.
People would actually be shocked at what lengths celebrities go to stay in the news. Whether it's wearing the same outfit as another celebrity so that they can appear in the Who Wore It Better commentary, or whether it's to date a new person just to remain relevant, because being relevant means that you get work.
Very few people are famous in the way that I think most people assume fame works. There's probably like a dozen people at any time who are Kim Kardashian famous, Lindsay Lohan famous, where if you go outside, there's gonna be paparazzi. If you're not one of those 12 people, you have to kind of find the paparazzi. You have to go to one of 10 places. You have to go to the Ivy, you have to go to one of 6 nightclubs.
The Hollywood publicity machine doesn't just support celebs. It also influences which films win awards.
There are PR campaigns that can be done to help actors and films garnish award nominations within all of the award shows. And I don't think the public would ever be aware. I don't even know if the public really even knows about the actual nomination processes within each award show. They're almost secret societies within all of the different organizations that handle the nominations. And there's probably a lot that I don't even know as a publicist, because it goes on with executives.
The campaigns for the Oscar ratchet up every year, and they're really serious. They're almost like on the level of political campaigns.
Whether it's campaigning for awards, making a scene at the right club, or even orchestrating a car crash, celebrities are always finding ways to stay in the spotlight. But could there be an even higher power in Hollywood than the publicity machine? Does divine inspiration exist in Tinseltown? Or is the bottom line Hollywood's only Bible? Coming up.
Not only was it okay to use sex to bring people into the organization, but it actually was a good deed, because you're converting someone to Christ.
Hollywood is like Sodom and Gomorrah with valet parking.
Hollywood is considered by many to be the most decadent place on earth.
Hollywood is like Sodom and Gomorrah with valet parking.
But in a town famous for its flagrant immorality and celebration of sin, some people might be surprised to know that conservative religious institutions have more influence than any other outside groups.
Christianity is big business. They own media empires. They own publishing empires. They are very, very big, and billions of dollars go into Christian programming and even movies. Mel Gibson's movies make hundreds of millions of dollars because Christians are as devout to the kind of entertainment that's put before them as they are to the doctrine that is handed to them every Sunday in church.
Most people in Hollywood
are not outwardly religious. And in contrast, many people in America are very religious. So what you'll often see studios do is try and figure out how to make their movie more attractive to a particular religious community. It's not in order to convert people, it's in order to make more money, which is ultimately the real religion of Hollywood.
Religious themes can be found in nearly any movie, but sometimes the studios will secretly go out of their way to make sure a blockbuster caters to a Christian audience.
With Man of Steel, Warner Brothers attempted to court a Christian movie-going audience, and they did that by offering early screenings to pastors, making some suggestions about scripture that relates to the movie, and generally sort of emphasizing themes that they felt were Christian in Man of Steel. It's actually not that unusual. Another movie where that was done recently is The Butler. There's even a totally different trailer for that movie, which has gospel music playing, and Oprah uses the word God, which is different from the one most people saw.
Denzel Washington, Mel Gibson, and Martin Sheen are just a few A-listers who are known to be devout Christians. But many in the entertainment business find themselves drawn in by more secretive and less mainstream religions.
Los Angeles is the best place to start a new religion. The way things happen here is they happen in private ceremonies, parties. So you meet people who want to take you into this place where there's some juice, there's some power, there's some wisdom.
With megastars like Madonna, Gwyneth Paltrow, Britney Spears, Paris Hilton, Ashton Kutcher, and Demi Moore all having joined its ranks at one time or another, a previously secret Jewish mysticism has gained a powerful following in Hollywood, Kabbalah.
It's a little-known, esoteric, ancient organization that teaches how to get in tune with the divine, how to really get in touch with God so that you can achieve your own levels of success that these celebrities so desire. How to, in a sense, become a god yourself.
Though Kabbalah is based on Jewish principles, some of the practices of its members, like holding cleansing dinners, wearing red string bracelets to ward off evil, and reading books written only in Aramaic, have raised eyebrows. Another religion that's gained an even bigger following in Hollywood and is even more secretive is the Church of Scientology. How has Scientology gained such a substantial A-list following? And why is the media so afraid to talk about this secret society?
Everybody was afraid. It's this secret celebrity club, but they have some really famous and powerful members. So we're not going to touch them because we don't want to jeopardize our relationship with those famous members. What are they doing in there? Why are these minions marching around Hollywood in sailor outfits? Is it a cult?
Scientology is one of the most fascinating things in Hollywood because there are so many celebrities involved and executives and writers and directors and producers that we don't know about and you don't hear about. And the little bits and pieces that ever come out seem to kind of go away and get squashed so quickly. That, I think, to me is what's most fascinating. There's an idea in Hollywood that you become a member because they hide things for you or help keep it out of the media.
The Church of Scientology is recognized in the United States and other countries as a legitimate religious organization. But Hollywood has also proven to be a breeding ground for many underground fringe religions, like the Children of God.
Children of God started in 1968 in Huntington Beach, California. Reverend Dave Berg starts preaching at this coffee shop, and it's kind of this like groovy hippie preacher. One day, Berg devised this plan called flirty fishing. Flirty fishing said that not only was it okay to use sex and sexuality to bring people into the organization, but it actually was a good thing. It was a good deed because you're converting someone to Christ. So imagine you're a Hollywood screenwriter, you're at a party in these hills, and all of a sudden you're being talked up by three beautiful young women. You find yourself in bed with them, and they ask you at that very particular moment if you take Jesus into your heart. And many did. Even today, we know a lot of young people who are on the rise as movie stars and recording artists and TV stars who grew up in that group.
The Children of God is still around today under a new name, the Family International, and it's only one of many fringe religious organizations in Hollywood.
There are a lot of secret societies in Hollywood. You know, what you see from the outside is only the tip of the iceberg, but you know, it goes deep. You see satanic rituals happening. You hear about them from friends. There are culty organizations springing up left and right. This is not an easy place. It can be very isolated. People join up with organizations that may not be beneficial for them.
With Hollywood's social and political influence, how concerned should we be about which top stars might secretly be involved with fringe religions?
Hollywood is this kind of testing ground, this way of like warning us about where we're headed in the future. I don't necessarily agree with this idea that we're at the behest of some kind of secret cabal. Now that said, I wouldn't be surprised if we are.
It's no secret that Hollywood has a strong effect on pop culture, and megastars may even influence people's religious beliefs. But might Hollywood wield even greater power than the public is aware? How strong a voice does Hollywood have in Washington, D.C.? Coming up.
Celebrities are very forceful in the political arena.
It's a lot easier to get a meeting if you're a famous actor or even a director than if you're probably an equally rich person who runs a trucking company.
Let us answer the call of history and carry into an uncertain future that precious light of freedom. Thank you, God bless you, and may he forever bless these United States of America.
For his 2012 election campaign, President Obama raked in millions from celebrity fundraisers thrown and attended by A-listers like George Clooney, Ellen DeGeneres, Leo DiCaprio, Steven Spielberg, Beyonce, and Jay-Z. Republican opponent Mitt Romney found his own big-name support from Chuck Norris, Ted Nugent, Kid Rock, Gene Simmons, and most memorably, Clint Eastwood and his empty chair act. But do celeb endorsements really help candidates at the ballot box? And what exactly qualifies the entertainment industry to have such strong political influence?
Celebrities are used to being in control. They're used to being able to give their opinion, and they have a lot of money. That can make them very forceful in the political arena.
People in the White House or in Washington are as starstruck as everyone else in America, so it's a lot easier to get a meeting if you're a famous actor or even a director than if you're probably an equally rich person who runs a trucking company.
Hollywood has been in bed with Washington since before movies even had sound. And surprisingly, one of the earliest political contributors was MGM studio boss Louis B. Mayer, a Republican. These days, there's no doubt that Hollywood is a liberal stronghold. But an underground conservative group known as the Friends of Abe is seeking to make waves from within.
The Friends of Abe was started by actor Gary Sinise, who felt that Republicans needed an organization where they could meet safely without feeling they were being persecuted. And they meet either at restaurants or at people's homes. It gets almost no publicity. But we know John Boehner has come in. Eric Cantor has come in. And a Judge Antonin Scalia has spoken to the group.
But is it really necessary for this secret society of Hollywood Republicans to be so clandestine? Or is it simply paranoia?
I don't make any secret about my political views, but I can understand the reticence, absolutely. I'll give you a little example of what it's like being a Republican in Hollywood. I wrote a column when Reagan was president about what life would be like day by day in the United States of America if the Russians took over. And that was bought to be made into a TV movie. And the producer-director said he would not go forward with it if my name appeared on the screen as story by Ben Stein, which would be the normal Writers Guild requirement, because he said, I will not have my name on the screen with someone who is associated with Richard Nixon. I think the general public would be astonished to know how incredibly, overwhelmingly liberal left-wing Hollywood is.
George Clooney had the dinner for Obama, $40,000 a plate, raised $15 million, which I remember hearing that and just thinking, that's insane.
Since the early days, the marriage between LA and DC has become a complex tale of codependence. Hollywood helps candidates raise campaign funds and reach out to voters, and Washington keeps its nose out of the filmmaking business, for the most part.
The greatest fear was Washington would come in and censor their films. And in fact, George Bush sent out Karl Rove to meet with a number of studio and television executives, asking them to cooperate with the government in its response to 9/11, and very subtly threatening repercussions for any studio or network that did not cooperate with the government.
The suits, as they call them, at the studios and the networks want to be friends with both parties. They don't know. The Republicans might come up with some great candidate next time, and suddenly they'll want to have friends at the Federal Communications Commission. They'll want to have friends in all kinds of regulatory agencies. So they definitely keep an oar on either side of the boat.
It's amazing the power that celebrities have over the political process, which is why Washington, D.C. recruits celebrities to promote their goals. Barack Obama essentially recruited Jay-Z to campaign for him. So if the average person were to be able to look behind the scenes and see the mechanisms at work, they would be quite surprised how the real power structure and the string pullers work.
When it comes to Hollywood and Washington, D.C., one hand washes the other. But is it possible the entertainment industry plays an even bigger role behind the scenes? Why are media moguls like Ted Turner, Steven Spielberg, and Rupert Murdoch attending private meetings with the world's most powerful leaders? Coming up.
Hollywood is a key of the Illuminati's power because it shapes the culture.
The Illuminati is the big boys. It's just a club of really powerful people. They got a lot of money. A group that want to push their agenda any way they can.
Religious and political organizations are slowly being outed as some of Hollywood's most powerful secret societies. But could there be something even bigger going on behind the scenes? The latest conspiracy theory in Hollywood is that a worldwide secret society is promoting its agenda through the manipulation of our most influential celebrities. Some call it the New World Order, while others say it's the Entertainment Illuminati, linked to an ancient secret society of powerful men.
The Illuminati was started in Germany in 1776 by Adam Weishaupt, who literally wrote plans down for how him and his secret society collaborators could take over the various sectors of power of society. The opinion shapers, the political power, the banking industry. And Adam Weishaupt knew back in the late 1700s that if you're going to shape a society, that you control the information.
But could this ancient secret society really still be around today? While it may sound far-fetched, some people within the Hollywood community are convinced there really are modern-day Illuminati pulling the strings.
The Illuminati is the big boys. It's just a club of really powerful people. They got a lot of money. A group that want to push their agenda any way they can. I don't know when they meet. I don't know exactly who they are, but got their hands in something. Definitely.
There's a lot of people who think that we're at the behest of this secret cabal, combination of the military and the intelligence communities and the oil business and the bankers. And those people also believe that Steven Spielberg is the head of the public relations part of that group.
Steven Spielberg secretly acting as the PR man for an organization bent on world domination? Such an idea might seem far-fetched, even if it were the plot of a Hollywood blockbuster. But there are some very real secret meetings that do take place between the entertainment industry elite and politicians. Every July, a large gathering descends upon a secluded campground just north of San Francisco. Surrounded by more security than the Playboy Mansion, this super-secret, all-male, two-week-long gathering is known as Bohemian Grove.
Bohemian Grove is on a 2,700-acre private redwood forest grove surrounded by barbed wire fences, security cameras, thermal imaging systems to make sure that no protesters go. It's surrounded by police and private security. Occasionally, photos, flyers, membership lists have been smuggled out, but it's very rare.
Founded by actor Henry Edwards in 1872, it was once just a gathering of artists and entertainers. But today, it's a veritable who's who of America's political powerhouses, captains of industry, banking bigwigs, and media moguls.
Bohemian Grove is a place where decisions are made, kind of like summer camp for white rich dudes.
The few attendees who've been willing to talk about Bohemian Grove claim it's nothing more than a chance to exchange ideas with other powerful people away from the spotlight. But there are some who believe major political decisions are made at this very secret retreat.
It's where the elite meet every summer, where they have these off-the-record talks about what's going on in the industries that they're involved in. The men that go there every summer are the key players in the political sphere and in the entertainment industry, in the news industry. These are the people that decide who's gonna run for office. There's a famous photo of Ronald Reagan and Richard Nixon sitting around a table inside the Bohemian Grove where they were discussing and plotting their political futures and deciding who was gonna run when. Years before Ronald Reagan actually became president.
If these are the types of deals being wheeled at Bohemian Grove, why have Clint Eastwood and James Woods been spotted there? And why is it attended by both Republicans and Democrats? Adding fuel to the theory that Hollywood is somehow influencing world events from behind the scenes is the Bilderberg Conference. This annual meeting where the world's most powerful people meet to discuss various global issues is just as heavily guarded as Bohemian Grove and is also attended by entertainment moguls like Ted Turner and Rupert Murdoch.
And then you have organizations like the Bilderberg Group, which operates as a secret society of the political, banking, and media elite that has met every year in secret since 1954 without a word in the mainstream media.
Although we may never know what goes on at places like Bohemian Grove and the Bilderberg Conference, one major Hollywood secret society was recently uncovered. And it has nothing to do with Illuminati or world domination, just what Hollywood loves most, cold, hard cash. Coming up.
Tobey Maguire was running a very high-stakes game, and I'm talking about there would be millions on that table at a time.
Exclusive parties where drugs are set out like hors d'oeuvres. Underground sex clubs where anything goes. Fringe religions that promote prostitution. Private meetings between politicians and celebrities. In Hollywood, what happens behind the scenes is often more intriguing than anything they put on the screen.
The rich and the famous in Hollywood do not play by the same set of rules. They get pretty much what they want, because they have the ultimate thing that everyone wants to be near, which is fame. There's really not much you can't do in this town if you know where to look.
Anything demons want to do on this earth has already been done in Hollywood.
Even in the information age, Hollywood's VIPs remain masters of keeping their private activities private. But sometimes, despite their best efforts, a secret society is exposed.
Everyone loves to play poker. It's great. It's okay to play within LA city limits, but if the house is taking a rake, i.e. taking an amount out of the money that's being put on the table, then it becomes illegal gambling. Tobey Maguire was running a very high-stakes game, and I'm talking about there would be millions on that table at a time. In fact, I tracked a guy all the way to Florida, a hedge fund guy, to talk to him about one single hand of poker. He had $1 million on it, and he was holding pocket aces, and he lost. Okay, $1 million with that hand. They welcome that kind of money into their game.
In a town that's all about high risk and high reward, it's no surprise that celebrities love to gamble. And when actors belly up to the poker table, they have a natural advantage.
Sooner or later, over time, they're gonna be the ones separating the rich guys from their money. And that's what poker's all about. It's a contact sport. And a lot of actors and celebrities are very good at it. You know, they have poker faces, they can act, they don't give off the tells.
Like most secret societies, the guys running this ultra-high stakes game took measures to make sure it remained underground.
They would have it up at Toby's house, in hotels such as the Roosevelt Hotel or the Four Seasons. They'd rent out suites. They had an organizer by the name of Molly Bloom. She was running the game, and it got too big.
Tobey Maguire denies that either he or Molly Bloom were taking a rake, and ultimately it was the indiscretions of an outsider that led to the downfall of the secret society.
Somebody vouched for a big hedge fund guy who had ripped off all his clients of millions of dollars, and he was losing that money in that poker game, and it turned into this big legal brouhaha because the bankruptcy trustee, in an effort to recover the money, found via checks that he had signed over to these guys. I mean, they left a paper trail a mile wide where the money was going, and sure enough, it was going into this game.
The top secret poker game was exposed, but in the end, Tobey Maguire and his celebrity friends lived to play another day. After all, this is Hollywood.
They all settled, you know, and when you settle, you know, you're not so much admitting wrongdoing as much as you are making a lawsuit go away.
The bottom line is when you're wealthy and you have a certain amount of fame to your name, you tend to get away with a lot of stuff.
In a town that's all about who you know, secret societies are everywhere. But might there also be other, even more incredible secret societies? Societies involving power. Societies involving money. Societies involving scandal. There are those who believe Hollywood's biggest players have more influence over our society than simply what appears in movie theaters and on television. Could it be true? Perhaps Hollywood's darkest and most secret societies have yet to be revealed.
When, you know, that they picked off her catalog on the internet, ultimately she got busted for transporting women across state lines for purposes of prostitution. And she got caught up in a sting in Orange County by the feds.
For Hollywood's top players, the ability to get sex on demand isn't restricted to the town's sun-drenched city limits. For 12 days each May, anybody who's anybody relocates to southern France for the Cannes International Film Festival. But when the festival is in town, Cannes also becomes a hotspot for people selling something other than movies.
As business becomes more global, one of those businesses that's going global is prostitution. And Cannes provides the very, very best. Yachts offshore. 200, 300-foot yachts. Each one, minimum of 20 women. Each one of those women getting paid anywhere between $5,000 and $40,000 a night. Now, if you're an actress and you made $40,000 the year before, but 3 years earlier you made $2 million, you probably still have a $2 million lifestyle. You also probably have a face that people recognize. Maybe times are tough. Maybe you go to Cannes. They're not giving $40,000 a night to somebody that came off the streets of Nice. They're giving $40,000 a night to somebody they saw on a movie screen.
Thanks, guys. Thanks.
Of course, while some Hollywood hotshots choose to keep their illicit liaisons private, others satisfy their carnal appetites by attending underground orgies that cater to everything from swinging to sex slaves. But even here, at clubs like Sanctum, you have to be a part of the secret VIP society to gain entrance.
You can't just buy a ticket, like going to Burning Man. They will decide who's allowed to come to their parties, and the ticket price does weed out anyone who may not be appropriate for the party.
I believe that Sanctum is the most secret society. It's so different from a normal party or a club. It's definitely a taboo. If you want to have sex in any room, you may, because that's what it is. It's a sex party. It's really an exciting and different kind of feeling, because you even get to smell the sex in the air, opposed to just sitting at home and watching porn.
There are dungeons where these dominatrixes are legally, you know, beating the hell out of these entertainment executives and or actors and even actresses, you know, who are into that sort of things. I know a lot of dominatrix who are making enviable amounts of money doing it.
There's definitely been simulated, you know, shows going on. I once saw one where Marie Antoinette herself was there, and she and her pony were having a great time together, and I thought, now that's a party.
Whether it's bondage and discipline or, you know, infantilism, dressing the celebrity up like a baby and, you know, putting a pacifier in its mouth and changing his diapers, you can get that in Hollywood as long as you can pay for it, and it doesn't come cheap.
For the Hollywood elite, nothing is out of bounds or out of reach. And A-list access extends well beyond wild parties and secret sex clubs. For the rich and famous, everything from shopping to eating dinner is done VIP style. Coming up.
Celebrities going to these private recovery centers where, under a different name, they're being taken care of by people who agree never to speak of it.
There's different rules for celebrities than there are for the rest of the world. Juries don't convict celebrities.
You can go anywhere you want. You can get anywhere you want. I'm not gonna bitch. It's an amazing life.
First, it was the gold card. Then it was the platinum. Now, it's the black card that really measures your street cred in the real world. But for Hollywood A-listers, their face and their fame is their fortune. That is, while it lasts.
Life for a Hollywood VIP is so different from the normal civilians. People just won't say no to them. If they want front row tickets to any sporting game, any music event, any film, if they want to go to a shop when it's in the middle of the night and wouldn't normally open, those kind of things are accessible to celebrities.
You can go anywhere you want. You can get anywhere you want. It is a different world when you become a celebrity. I'm not gonna bitch, it's an amazing life.
For Hollywood's heaviest hitters, the VIP treatment extends to every aspect of their lives. When flying into Los Angeles, a true celeb makes the scene in a private plane, and waiting to pick them up is the real super shuttle.
There is a certain phone number that you call when you come into town. And when you call that number, arriving to pick you up at your private jet at Santa Monica Airport is a stretch limo driven by a very attractive woman. And inside that limo is every single narcotic or vice you could want. And it's there for your beck and call. You just have to know who to call. And that number just doesn't go out to, anybody.
And if you thought you'd catch a glimpse of J-Lo shopping for munchies at the local supermarket, forget it.
Hollywood VIPs definitely do not shop like regular citizens. For the right VIP, I can close stores. Stores usually get closed down when it's such a big customer that they have no other reason to stay open. They'll make more money on this one customer alone than they would all day with pedestrian shopping for a scarf or perfume.
But for Hollywood VIPs, the most important access is to other celebrities. And where better to rub shoulders with your fellow members of the rich and famous than at places like West LA's Equinox Fitness Club, where superstars from movies, TV, and music suit up to get all up close and sweaty on the basketball court. It's called the E-League, a secret club that holds weekly closed-door matchups, and it's masterminded by film producer and former NBA marketing guru, Shane Duffy.
He decided that he wanted to get the best players he could to play in the league. All celebrities, but they had to be good. So he has a personal tryout for every celebrity. Snoop Dogg had to try out. Frankie Munoz had to try out. Justin Timberlake had to try out. And this league pits all these celebrities against each other.
And when E-leaguers like Leonardo DiCaprio, Adam Sandler, Ice Cube, and Will Ferrell leave the court to grab a bite, they do it Hollywood style. No reservations required.
What you don't know is that there's always a table kept vacant in the top Hollywood establishments, just in case Justin Bieber or another A-list star wants to come in right at the last moment.
VIP tables are for a certain level of VIP. And then there's like another level of VIP. There's like the table that's like You want everybody that walks into that restaurant to see you sitting there. Because you want everyone to walk in and be like, oh, dude, it's that other table that's like way over there in the back in the corner where no one can really see, where the lights are a little dimmer. Those are the real VIPs. Right now in LA, the hardest table to get is at Urasawa. It's like 10 seats. Very delicate, beautiful things, and very artistic with their taste and their smell and the texture. And it's about $500 a person. It's worth it.
Of course, if you're really an A-lister, you need to do more than just spend your way to the top. You need to be invited. And for the right price, you can join one of the town's ultra-private, members-only clubs, like Soho House, hidden in plain sight on top of this 14-story building on Sunset Boulevard.
It's the one place where celebrities actually feel safe. Soho has initiation fees, annual membership fees. There's applications to fill out, and you have to know somebody. You can't just go up and knock on the door and say, I'd like to go to Soho.
But believe it or not, the real Hollywood E-ticket, as far as private clubs go, can be found at the very place where the E-ticket was invented. That's right, Disneyland. Because for Hollywood celebrities, Club 33 really is the happiest place on Earth.
Club 33 is a very, very private members club that's part of Disneyland. It's the kind of place Tom Hanks goes, Jack Nicholson goes, Vanessa Hudgens recently went. Even if you're a celebrity, you need serious cash to be able to go here. It's a $25,000 initiation fee, and then it's $10,000 every single year.
In Hollywood, even more important than how much money you have is who you know. Several nights every summer, a select few are invited to a secret location just west of downtown LA in Hancock Park. At a 100-year-old mansion, the chosen ones drink and mingle in a secluded garden, waiting to experience a show most in Hollywood have never even heard of. But this ultra-exclusive venue is not what you might expect. It's run by magicians. The only people more secretive than celebrities. Originally opened in 1933, Brookledge was a favorite hangout of Houdini and Orson Welles, and is the precursor to Hollywood's world-famous Magic Castle, where only members and their guests are allowed in.
The Magic Castle is the most unusual club in Hollywood. And they actually have secret rooms. It's very difficult to find out information about what's going on inside.
In 2009, the owners of the Magic Castle upped the ultra-exclusive ante when they reopened Brookledge, which has been closed since the castle opened in 1963. And no cameras have ever been allowed through the gates until now.
Let's hope nothing too sinister happens tonight.
What they allowed to be filmed reveals a mashup of music, magic, and the bizarre.
I've seen everything here from prestidigitation to performance art to literally life-endangering tricks.
But most in Hollywood will never see what goes on at the Brookledge Follies because it's strictly invite-only.
If you don't know someone who knows someone, there's no way you would hear about it or get in.
There's a lot of secret Hollywoods, and this is definitely one of them.
From invite-only parties to secret celebrity sports leagues and member-only clubs, the Hollywood in-crowd lead the type of lives most people can only dream of. But when celebrities don't want their private activities ending up public knowledge, how do they keep it all under wraps? In Hollywood, there's one important rule to live by. Keep your friends close and your assistants closer. Coming up.
It's like running away to join the circus, but then discovering that when nobody's looking, the animals do unspeakable things to each other.
Hollywood fixtures, they're human garbage men, and they clean up the messes that celebrities and power brokers leave in their wake.
In Hollywood, a celebrity's closest allies aren't their friends, managers, or agents. It's their personal assistants. Why?
Hi, Beyonce.
Because no one has more dirt on the stars than the people hired to do their dirty work. And one of their jobs is to keep their mouth shut.
Personal assistants have actually peed in cups for the celebrities so that if they're having a drug test, the celebrity comes across as clean.
In many celebrities' lives, there is the public persona they put out, and then there's the secret life that they want to protect. So they make sure that anyone that they do allow into this secret world, they can control.
Having intimate knowledge of a celebrity's life makes personal assistants a secret society within a secret society. It's a tight-knit community fueled by loyalty and discretion.
A celebrity assistant may be the one who, if there's going to be a raid, disposes of the drugs. They are asked to maybe drive after an accident, pretend they were driving when the celebrity was driving.
When you become an assistant to a celebrity or a Tinseltown bigwig, it's like running away to join the circus, but then discovering that when nobody's looking, the animals do unspeakable things to each other and to themselves. The draw really is a ground level opportunity to rocket yourself into a gated community of actors and executives and creators in general. The secret to getting a job as an assistant is that you have to know somebody. The savvy assistants, they leapfrog to better positions. So once you are in the club, your network of assistants are the same people that you're going to go up through the ranks with.
In Hollywood, personal assistants handle nearly every aspect of their employers' lives, giving them access to social security numbers, bank accounts, family secrets, health records, and other intimate personal details. It's a risky business entrusting so much to one person, and if it doesn't work out, sometimes it's the boss who stands to lose the most.
Ricky Lake talked about delivering her infant son at home via water birth, and then she had asked her assistant to clean the tub afterwards. And you know that's an assistant you can trust because that placenta did not end up on eBay.
All right, thank you very much.
Nearly as close as personal assistants, but also literally in the line of fire, are the stars' bodyguards. But in addition to shielding their clients and their families from physical harm, they also guard them from the prying eyes and cameras of the paparazzi.
For some celebrities, going out and partying is as secure as what I would imagine that the president would have. And sometimes what they get up to, if that ever came out, it could actually ruin a career.
Some, shall we say, overzealous bodyguards have even been sued while in the employ of megastars like Justin Bieber, Britney Spears, and Leonardo DiCaprio. But what are these bodyguards so aggressively trying to hide? And why are so many of these celebrity-related lawsuits suddenly and mysteriously dropped? That's where the person known as the fixer comes in.
Hollywood fixers, they're human garbage men, and they clean up the messes that celebrities and power brokers leave in their wake. Hollywood fixers go back to the golden age. These are shady gumshoe types, not unlike myself, who know how to assess a situation when there's a problem, when irreparable damage can be caused to the celebrity who's involved in something shady. And these are the guys who make the problems go away, hence the name fixers.
Hollywood fixers do exist, and I happen to be one of them. I think probably one of the more infamous ones would be Anthony Pelicano. Anthony was great at what he did.
The Harvey Keitel character you saw in Pulp Fiction, he really exists. He's not going to help you maybe dispose of a murdered body, although back in the 50s and 60s during the studio system, he probably would have. Now the fixers are generally called crisis managers. They handle clients who are in big, big trouble. They've handled Michael Vick. They've handled R. Kelly.
Usually, that big, big trouble involves another person. Maybe the victim of a star's temper tantrum, a battered lover, or someone with incriminating information or photos.
Sometimes the injured parties can be convinced not to go forward. And if you don't have an injured party going forward or somebody who wants to cooperate with the investigation, you have nothing. You just want to find out how much money do you want to make this go away. And you'd be surprised. Greed is good.
But there are some problems even a fixer can't fix. And where bodyguards and personal assistants can only go so far. What happens when a Hollywood VIP's worst enemy is himself? Coming up.
In Hollywood, the VIPs, quite often, their drug dealers are actual physicians.
I'm shocked at the life that these people live behind these gates.
For those living in the Hollywood fast lane, designer drugs are as common a party favor as chips and dip. Many of the most exclusive VIP events have a Willy Wonka-like selection of uppers and downers available right from the bar. And the hot new drink is a codeine concoction that goes by the names Scissor, Purple Drink, and most appropriately, Lean.
Lean, they call it lean because it makes you go like this. It's a cough medicine with codeine mixed with some sort of purple soda. They drink this stuff like soda pop all day long, and by the end of the day, you're leaning to the point where you're falling flat on your face.
It may come as no surprise that in La La Land, drugs are rampant. But according to those on the inside, there's a secret network of drug users within the Hollywood community, and the public has no idea just how wild the party can really get.
It happens in the bathroom, it happens in the back bedroom, because you never know who's gonna see it and judge it. So there is sort of a secret society of people who know that they all do hard drugs, and it's sort of a nod and a let's go over there.
The drugs are either designer drugs like ecstasy, ketamine, OxyContin, narcotics, painkillers are really popular in Hollywood and really addictive.
That's right. The hottest drugs in Hollywood are legal, with a prescription, that is. And in this town, even more valuable than a celebrity's autograph is their doctors.
In Hollywood, the VIPs, quite often, their drug dealers are actual physicians, the legendary Dr. Feelgoods. These are doctors who have a small handful of very wealthy clients, and they're making $1 million a year peddling drugs.
A lot of celebrities maintain this perfect aura by relying on the help of drugs. There are drugs that help them get skinny. There are drugs that help them look more youthful. There are drugs that give them energy to help them keep going on their long hours and party into the wee hours of the morning.
Today, prescription drugs are more popular than ever, thanks in part to the fact that the only thing more addictive than drugs is celebrity.
I'm trying to show the world a different side of me, that's all.
There are doctors out there that will see 100 patients a day, and they'll charge $100. So they're making $10,000 a day, 5 days a week. And what they're doing is they're just writing out prescriptions for pills. Doctors will take pictures of celebrities and hang them on their wall. And so when other patients come in, they see the celebrity and they go, oh my goodness, this must be the best doctor ever.
While scripts are more in vogue than ever, illegal narcotics are just as popular among the Hollywood elite and just as easy to score.
So what you have in Hollywood, you have a lot of middlemen. It's not middlemen trying to make money. What they're trying to do is be friends with a celebrity. Being around a celebrity is addictive. They want to go to the great clubs. They want to ride on a private jet. They want to ride in limos. Celebrities then stay insulated.
When you've got a person who may be calling the shots for hundreds of people, they get away with murder.
But could it be more than just the baller lifestyle and unlimited access that's behind the widespread drug use in Hollywood? Some believe the very traits that drive a person to be famous also leave them more susceptible to becoming addicted to hardcore drugs.
There's kind of been studies about it, actually, that there's a certain type of personality that wants to become famous, and it's a very similar kind of personality to people who do have that kind of addictive gene.
When Tom Sizemore was doing Natural Born Killers, there was a scene where he had to snort cocaine, and he went and asked a grip and said, get me real cocaine, because that's what I need to do, and that's what happened.
Drugs always have been, and probably always will be, part of the Hollywood culture. But like most things in this town, the reality is never as glamorous as what you see on the screen.
I think people have these ideas that celebrities, you know, they're living the life, they have all this money and just cocaine and whatever they want. Well, actually, doing cocaine is one of the loneliest things you can possibly do in the world. And addiction is masking terrible pain and trauma and sadness.
When you drive by Forest Lawn, that beautiful white mansion, the beautiful lawns, the fountain, behind the scenes, it's like a slaughterhouse. Hollywood is no different. The red carpet, the big smiles, the limos, the flashing lights, the nicely dressed celebrities. And how many times have you watched that? And then days or weeks or a month later, the individual's dead, died of an overdose. I'm shocked at the life that these people live behind these gates.
Sooner or later, most drug addicts end up behind bars. But when you're among the Hollywood elite, a dangerous meth habit is more likely to land you in a Malibu mansion. Coming up.
Rehab is probably one of the biggest scams going.
Look, I get art therapy, I get horse therapy. I don't get combining the two.
In Hollywood, drugs are so much a part of the culture that most heavy hitters will take a bump with as little fear of the law as a jaywalker.
There's just tons of people who are ready to give you what you want. It's nuts.
But even A-list addicts eventually have to face the music. Only for them, it's a much different tune.
The bottom line is when you're wealthy and you have a certain amount of fame to your name, you tend to get away with a lot of stuff.
When celebrities hit rock bottom, high-end rehabs are there to help them pick up the pieces. While the Betty Ford Clinic used to be the hot ticket for celebrity rehab, it pales in comparison to the newer luxury treatment centers catering to the stars.
2 years ago, we thought $30,000 a month was a lot to pay for a month-long stay in a rehab. Now we've got recovery centers that are charging up to six figures, $96,000, $100,000 a month. There's no secret why the rehab and recovery industry in and around Hollywood is probably a $25 billion a year industry.
There are treatment centers that are $95,000 a month where you're kind of allowed to do whatever you want. They also have 500 thread count sheets and suits and all these sort of luxury amenities.
A lot of them are strategically placed on cliffs overlooking the Pacific Ocean. They call themselves recovery centers, coddling and nurturing and feeding and offering all kinds of distractions by way of movie nights and haute cuisine and field trips and surf lessons and things as absurd as, believe it or not, equine therapy.
There are ridiculous things that people do. There was a rehab that was doing horse painting where you take a horse and you paint on it. Look, I get art therapy, I get horse therapy. I don't get combining the two. There was a doctor that was detoxing celebrities for 10 grand a day at a Beverly Hills hotel. He would detox you.
There was a big, big celebrity who I was told was going into rehab in that person's own home. And that was how they were keeping it private. And I remember the celebrity actually calling me from their house and saying, I'm not in rehab. And I was like, I know, you're doing it at your house.
There are a lot of quick fixes that money can buy, you know, to allegedly help an addict get through the withdrawal process. There's a lot of folklore about literally some celebrities having, you know, their blood drained and replaced. There are expensive drugs that they can replace the drugs that you've been putting in your body, and things that can lessen the horrible sort of suffering that comes along with drug and alcohol withdrawal.
But is rehabilitation from a hardcore drug problem really possible while sitting in the lap of luxury?
The nature of addiction is, sooner or later, you have to, quote unquote, hit your bottom. And that means whether it takes you literally to Skid Row or the Skid Row is a state of mind, you need to be down and out in order to look up and get better. Well, they do everything possible not to let you reach that bottom that is necessary.
Rehab is probably one of the biggest scams going. If it's not done right, it's not gonna work. And Rite Aid is making sure that you get medical treatment, that you're hospitalized in a real hospital, and you get real treatment. And if you're real successful at failing at rehab, you end up dead. And I think that list is a big list in this town.
The best secret to getting sober is unfortunate for celebrities because it's finding humility and it's sort of really believing and accepting you are just.
From ultra elite clubs.
There was a guy who just spent $1.3 million in one evening.
To A-list after parties.
No matter how good a party crasher you are, you will not get access.
And exclusive VIP events.
We have a heavy screening process. You can't just buy a ticket.
Beyond the red carpets and movie sets lies a forbidden Hollywood known only to the rich and famous.
Life for a Hollywood VIP is so different from the normal civilian. They can have anything they want at any time.
But what really goes on behind the scenes?
The Harvey Keitel character you saw in Pulp Fiction, he really exists.
How far will celebrities go to cover up a scandal?
How much money do you want to make this just go away?
And what shocking truths might be exposed when we draw back the curtain and take a glimpse into secret societies of Hollywood? Hollywood, California. For nearly a century, it has been the playground of the rich and famous. But behind the locked doors and security gates is a world known only to a privileged few. A world that those on the inside will do anything to remain a part of.
The creme de la creme of all of Hollywood. They can have anything they want at any time. Kind of things that we are told but can't print would blow your mind. If you're famous, you can get anything.
Ever since the earliest days of Hollywood, members of the entertainment industry elite have had to form secret alliances to remain viable in the world of luxury and privacy they've come to cherish. But what are these secret societies? Who's in them? And what do you have to do to be a member?
When it comes to getting away with things, celebrities get away with, I would say, everything.
Celebrities like to hang out in their kind of secret groups, in their secret clubs.
Being a Hollywood VIP comes with one very important perk, something only money and fame can buy, VIP access. And nowhere is that more important than at the doors to the city's most exclusive clubs and parties.
The top nightclub VIP rooms are difficult to access. You have to know the right person or be the right person, and that's it. And once you get in there, it's a free-for-all. Celebrities let their hair down, and it's a party.
The VIP rooms in Hollywood now are sort of obsolete in favor of VIP clubs. So you do smaller clubs that cater to the kings and queens of the city. And then within that, you have tables that create the real estate that they even feel more protected.
Dean May and Tony Daly are two of Hollywood's most prominent party promoters. Born and raised in Los Angeles, they've turned their personal relationships with the rich and famous into careers as party promoters for SBE, one of the world's preeminent luxury hospitality enterprises.
Los Angeles is a promoter-driven town. Promoters are the kings of LA, and what good promoters are doing what nights is kind of dictates what goes on.
Party promoters hold the keys to the most exclusive venues in the city.
Back up, guys.
They strive to give their celebrity clients not just a safe haven away from the public and paparazzi, but also a unique experience that'll keep the town's A-listers coming back for more.
One of our venues, the Sayers Club, you actually go through what used to be a hot dog stand. It's an indiscriminate front entrance, no signs, and you're either in or you're out. There's no line. There's a club on Hollywood Boulevard where they open three different doors and only one door actually opens. Once you get inside, the girl on the bed asks you a question, and if you answer it right, a hydraulic system pulls the bed away with the girl on it, and it reveals the stairs that takes you down into the bar. It's so elitist that we don't even do a red rope. You just don't even know where it is.
The hottest club right now is Beecher's Madhouse in the Hollywood Roosevelt Hotel. You enter through a bookcase, and once inside, it is like a circus. There are little people working as bartenders. There are burlesque dancers. There are transvestites. I mean, it is a madhouse, and celebrities love it.
You're never quite sure what's going to take place inside there. Miley Cyrus loves to party there. It's become a place where every A-lister likes to go.
Paris, up here, baby. Come on.
I would say that the hardest consistent door to get into in Los Angeles is Greystone Manor. It's probably in 15 rap songs right now. It's got a Sunday night hip-hop party that people literally come to Los Angeles for.
Of course, for some celebrities, the best way to make sure a club meets your expectations is to run your own. Stars like Charlie Sheen, Jay-Z, and Shaquille O'Neal have invested big money in VIP venues where they can party hard with their very own inner circle. And all away from the prying eyes and cameras of the paparazzi.
Bellows has become a really big place for especially young Hollywood. It's owned by David Arquette and John Terzian. And what happens inside that club doesn't get out. So celebrities know that they can go there, they can party, they can dance. Selena Gomez famously went to Bootsy Bellows for her 21st birthday.
Those who manage to get past security at these Hollywood hotspots enter a world where celebrities and their pals can behave as they please. There's no holds barred.
They'll have these buffets where you have this beautiful woman or beautiful man laying on a table just covered in sushi. And everyone will come up, and I've watched this. It's just take the food off them, and you slowly reveal each part of their body as you eat this amazing sushi. It's amazing.
Of course, it should come as no surprise that in a world where money talks, the one who spends the most talks the loudest.
There was a guy who just spent $1.3 million in one evening buying 15 liters of Ace Rosé at over $100,000 a bottle. You'll see guys come in and they'll be five of them and they'll order 50 bottles of Cristal. And then before you know it, everybody's carefree because this guy's paying for everything. And, you know, you try and drink the whole 50 bottles.
It makes for an amazing night when those guys come in. It's a lot of fun.
Sure, these nightclubs are wild and crazy, but believe it or not, they're just a warm-up for what goes on at the even more exclusive after-parties.
What people don't know about Hollywood is, even though the bars shut at 2, that's when things get going and you go to the private house parties.
It's like a high-end frat party at some $10 million mansion.
Yeah. After-hours house parties, you're more likely to see celebrities than you would inside the nightclub because it's more sheltered, and in the club, different people can get in. At house parties, it's way more controlled and there's more security.
No matter how good a party crasher you are, you will not get access.
In a town like this, the real power brokers aren't the studio chiefs. They're the party promoters, the bouncers, and the bodyguards. They're the gatekeepers who decide who gets in and who gets close. They also do whatever it takes to ensure that what happens at the party stays at the party.
In fact, they confiscate your cell phone and they run a metal detector over you to make sure that you don't have any other things that they missed. They also take the batteries out of the cell phones just in case you manage to grab it.
They'll even sometimes have people sign NDA, so non-disclosure confidentiality agreements, so that if somebody does speak about their night with Justin Bieber or whatever it might be, that they could actually get sued.
Located just 24 miles northwest of Hollywood, the gated hilltop community of Calabasas boasts A-list residents like Jennifer Lopez, Drake, and the Kardashians. It's also home to the most infamous event in town, Justin Bieber's Wild Kids Parties.
Justin Bieber is known for having quite wild parties, and we know this actually because some of his neighbors have spoken. They've been very angry about the noise and the loud music and the driving of the fast cars in the neighborhood.
Now, he didn't always make people sign non-disclosure agreements, so we do know what happens in some of his parties. It's one guy for four or five girls. Now, what Justin would do is he would go up to the girls and he'd ask them three or four or five questions. And if they gave the right kind of answer that Justin was looking for, then he would take them back into a bedroom. It's generally different women every single night. And these parties are becoming legendary, and they are definitely an exclusive ticket, but maybe not a ticket that you want your daughter to go to.
But whether it's a secret nightclub, a VIP room, or even a private house party, once a hotspot loses its cool factor, there's always another ultra-decadent destination ready to take its place.
There's so many parties in Hollywood that you can't talk about. Every night, there's secret things happening all over the place that if you discussed, then you'd never be able to go to again, and you wouldn't be knowing about them.
Coming up.
One thing that a convention always needs, hookers. And Cannes provides the very, very best.
Whether it's bondage and discipline or dressing the celebrity up like a baby and, you know, putting a pacifier in its mouth and changing his diapers, you can get that in Hollywood as long as you can pay for it, and it doesn't come cheap.
Hollywood is no stranger to scandal. And when it comes to media coverage, the sexier the scandal, the better. But whether it's a leaked sex tape or an actor coming out of the closet, there's much more going on under the Hollywood covers and within Hollywood's secret societies than the public knows.
I've heard some crazy stories over the years about what really happens at these private parties, from wife swapping, swinger parties, just nakedness, a ton of drugs. There's one particular starlet, very young in Hollywood at the moment, that apparently walks around her parties naked.
Some of these parties become very erotic. We walk into this beautiful ambiance of Eyes Wide Shut masquerade, and everyone's kind of anonymous. And as they loosen up through the evening, they become less anonymous, and people make new friends. The experience is very kind of Cirque meets 50 Shades.
Heidi Fleiss, aka the Hollywood Madam, became a celebrity herself when it was revealed she had been supplying prostitutes for an elite clientele, including everyone's favorite bad boy, Charlie Sheen.
The sex parties that have existed in Hollywood for years, if not decades, are stuff of legend. There was a Chinese guy, I won't mention his name, let's just call him AC. AC used to run a weekly party, and people would show up in their Mercedes and their Bentleys, and it was like you had a harem. Mostly strippers and porn stars, they mingled with you while you were having your drinks, and then you'd see people couple off and move into various rooms in the mansion, and it was wholesale prostitution.
More recently, Michelle Braun ran Nikki's Girls, an online brothel, arranging introductions between ultra-rich men and everyone from Playboy models and actresses to beauty queens.
Michelle Braun got started in the business because she was at a party. This dot-com millionaire said, you know what I'd really like to do? I'd really, really like to have sex with a Playboy playmate. She called up one of her friends who was a playmate and said, there's this guy who's willing to pay you $50,000 for sex. The woman said, I'm in. So Michelle went back to the guy and said, she's willing to do it, but it's going to cost you $250,000. Michelle Braun made $200,000 that night and was hooked.
She was very much a Hollywood player and had a great business sense. Rich guys have needs, and she filled it.
She was allegedly supplying girls to everyone from Tiger Woods down in Florida to anybody here that wanted a specific playmate, a specific porn star, or just someone.
It's the same as everybody else, which is such a challenge for celebrities when you've got the whole world treating you like you're better than everyone else.
The real question is, how are you gonna stay stopped? This calls for a fundamental change in you. And if that change doesn't come about, as soon as you get clean, you know, the first call you're gonna make after you call your agent is to call your drug dealer.
But although rehab in Hollywood is more caviar than cold turkey, some celebrities do find a way to get clean, and often through the counsel of another celebrity.
I remember with Tom Sizemore, what his family did is they got Robert De Niro, who is his idol, to come to the intervention. And that's going to work. Matthew Perry is an amazing example of somebody who very publicly suffered with addiction. But when he finally got sober, I think that he became determined to sort of try to change the face of what addiction is. He took this beautiful house that he has in Malibu and turned it into a sober living house.
For most who've had a taste of the rock star lifestyle, it doesn't take much to veer off the straight and narrow. And for the Hollywood elite, when all the hard living catches up with them, their VIP access extends to the doctor's office as well. Coming up.
Human growth hormone, testosterone, estrogen treatments. These things are used by a huge percentage of people in Hollywood.
People would be surprised if they knew the number of things people in Hollywood do to sort of look a certain way.
In LA, you can party like a rock star, pop pills like candy, and even do a couple of stints in rehab. But one thing you can't do is let it take a toll on your looks. How do Hollywood VIPs manage to live life in the fast lane without showing the mileage? And what secret societies exist to keep the beautiful people looking beautiful?
I think people would be surprised if they knew the number of things people in Hollywood do to sort of look a certain way.
When people become famous, I immediately notice that they lose weight and their hair gets blonder. Their teeth get whiter, and then they get capped, and then their wrinkles start to disappear, and then their nose becomes thinner, and then their chin becomes a little more defined, and then their breasts become larger.
In Hollywood, you basically bring two things to the table, talent and your looks. Your talent perseveres, but if your looks don't, you're out.
Shrouded in a veil of secrecy, the world's top health and beauty gurus are called in when a celebrity is preparing for a role, walking the red carpet, or just undergoing some regularly scheduled maintenance. The first line of defense against Father Time is Hollywood's Barbell Brain Trust, the top personal trainers in the industry who train their clients either at their homes or at ultra-high-tech underground gyms.
There definitely are ultra-exclusive gyms. I mean, Hollywood's all about being a VIP, being ultra-exclusive.
Tucked away in a Beverly Hills alley is the entrance to a top-secret facility where A-list names like Affleck, Perry, and Messing sneak in to work out. In-demand celebrity trainer Adam Ernster built the aptly named Bunker Gym, complete with high-tech biometric access, so his clients would have a private place to break a sweat.
The Bunker in Beverly Hills is an ultra-exclusive, invitation-only gym. It has a paparazzi-proof garage and is very difficult to get into. Inside, it has state-of-the-art equipment and amazing instructors.
While it might be uncool to pant in public, you have to wonder if there's another reason VIPs prefer to get fit under top security.
They just look better than everybody else. I always say that Hollywood celebrities are like humans on steroids.
But some celebrities don't just look like humans on steroids. Every year, more and more athletes are getting exposed for steroid use. But it's not just sports stars that feel the need to juice. When an actor has to get ripped in a hurry, there's no better way to prepare for a performance than with performance-enhancing drugs.
One story that I think is a big one in Hollywood that people are reluctant to talk about is how actors transform their bodies for roles. We often hear about people going to trainers and following a particular diet, and it's true, they do all that. But there are some other things people do to become a big, giant superhero or whatever they're playing that would surprise people.
Everyone's looking for that quick fix. And for celebrities, it's their job to stay fit, to look good, to be at their peak all the time. So they're trying to lead superhero lives.
And it's not just steroids that actors are injecting to preserve their youth.
Hollywood is very into hormone treatments, injections to keep your skin looking amazing, to keep your body fat down, to allow you to get ripped. People would be shocked if they knew how common it was for people to use hormone replacement therapy, human growth hormone, testosterone, estrogen treatments. These things are used by a huge percentage of people in Hollywood. Not particularly legal, but they're very effective in keeping you strong and youthful looking.
But sometimes even drugs aren't enough to keep an A-lister looking up to snuff. That's when they resort to more drastic measures. Going under the knife has become Hollywood's bottomless fountain of youth.
Hollywood is the plastic surgery center of the universe.
Whether it's HGH or Botox, they're all doing something. Breast lifts, facelifts, nose jobs, eye lifts, lip injections. It goes on and on and on. They've all done something. Plastic surgery is something that they don't want to admit. Plastic surgery would show that they're not the most beautiful person on the planet, that they needed some kind of little extra boost to make them like that.
In Hollywood, men are much more secretive about plastic surgery than women, and men do very different procedures than women. Men do, of course, hair transplants, a lot of upper eyelid surgery, some facelift surgery, and a lot of liposuction, whereas women, it basically runs the gamut. Men won't tell you about it at all. Whereas women are willing to come forward and say, yeah, I had a little nip and tuck.
These days, a little nip and tuck doesn't necessarily involve a knife. The Hollywood A-list is known for being first to jump on the experimental treatment bandwagon, hoping to find the latest and greatest quick fix.
I have heard from a esthetician friend of mine that celebrities are putting stem cells on their face to look younger, which is basically the umbilical cord of babies on their face. So that's a new one. I don't think I would go that far.
The big thing in Hollywood right now are the non-invasive things. The laser treatments, the thermages, the ultrasounds, the heating up of the skin to prevent it from becoming lax and dropping. Another thing we do is freeze fat. If you've got a little excess fat in certain areas that's diet resistant, we can freeze it externally and the cells die and you basically just urinate them out. Vaginal rejuvenation refers to a number of procedures you do down there. Reducing what's called the labia minora is really hot in Hollywood right now.
But no matter what or where they nip and tuck, if a celebrity hopes to keep their secret enhancement secret, they heal up away from the prying eyes of the paparazzi at recovery centers designed to look more like luxury condos.
Celebrities are not going into any hospitals. They're going to these private recovery centers where, under a different name, they're being taken care of by people who sign non-disclosure agreements who agree never to speak of it.
There is a recovery center so exclusive that they only allow 3 patients at a time. 3. That's it. Each one is charged $100,000 for 1 month. That is the most exclusive recovery center that there is. Most of the recovery centers are way nicer than any vacation that you and I will ever take.
The rich and famous will go to any length to preserve their beauty and to keep the public from knowing about it. But no matter how many precautions celebrities take to ensure that their private lives stay private, in the internet age, it's impossible to keep everything hidden. Of course, for the rich and famous, there's almost no crisis their people can't manage. Coming up.
There are people paid every day to stop things from going in tabloids.
I've never felt that the playing field of the criminal justice system is fair and flat. It's flat and fair for some people, but it's very hilly with some big pits for a lot of others.
Welcome back to New York.
From bodyguards to fixers to plastic surgeons, the biggest Hollywood celebs employ an impressive entourage to keep their image intact. But living large can lead to superstar-sized problems. And when that happens, it's time to call in the crisis management team. in the face of this secret society is the publicist.
We sort of get blamed for everything that goes wrong in a celebrity's career. And then you cross into the realm of damage control PR and scandals and who did your client sleep with and are they breaking up a marriage and did they have a DUI yesterday? We're sort of like a parent, an assistant, a therapist, a bail bondsman. It's crazy how much goes on and then we don't get enough credit from our clients.
There are people paid every day to stop things from going in tabloids, the media, so that they shut it down real quick.
Damage control has been essential to celebrities since the golden age of Hollywood, long before the time of Lindsay, Britney, and Paris.
They were called flaks back in the day. You wear a flak jacket when you're in combat to shield you from bullets and shrapnel hitting you, and they used their publicists to kind of protect them from anything negative sort of flying at them.
Publicists work in cahoots with their extensive Hollywood network to limit the damage from public scandal. But once legal repercussions are looming, it's time to bring out the big guns. Hollywood power players have their pick of the world's best lawyers. Lucky for them, the most ruthless ones live in L.A. Attorneys like Mark Garagos and Marty Mad Dog Singer have saved scores of celebrities from prison. Just ask Chris Brown.
Chris Brown really owes a lot to his attorney, Mark Garagos, who was able to take a really horrible situation. We all saw those pictures of Rihanna's face badly beaten, and he kept him undercover for a while so people could kind of forget what happened. He brought out the story of Chris Brown and his problems, and then he had Chris really focus on his talent so people could remember what they loved about Chris Brown in the first place.
A few years later, Chris Brown's a star again. And it has a lot to do with Mark Garagos. You'll see him on Larry King. He knows how to handle the media. He's very, very good at what he does, and he managed to restore the reputation of somebody that everybody in America literally hated.
Garagos got Chris Brown 5 years probation. He helped get Michael Jackson acquitted and got Winona Ryder wrist slapped with a fine, community service, and counseling.
Some of the secrets the celebrity lawyers use with their clients to help project this innocent appearance. They tell them how to dress, put the sweet little sweater on, wear your hair pulled back, minimal makeup, look down when you're in court, look sorry, say yes ma'am, no ma'am, don't smile too much.
There's different rules for celebrities than there are for the rest of the world. Juries don't convict celebrities. And it's not so much that the prosecutors are afraid of them, it's that they know that the jury of the peers are never ever gonna convict them. So they just choose to offer up some kind of plea deal.
The hardest thing about a celebrity trial is what I call the celebrity phenomenon. Rather than just judging them on the crime they committed, they're looking at their movie history or their athletic ability, and they already have this halo effect. I remember I was in the courtroom when O.J. Simpson walked in. I knew that he was guilty, and yet you felt that presence. He walked in with that suit that was cut beautifully, and every woman and man sat there and their jaw dropped because he just had that presence.
But might some of Hollywood's most powerful attorneys also engage in shady dealings to protect their troubled VIP clientele?
I've seen them do things that would, in any other town, would get them disbarred in a hot minute. Things like suborning perjury, getting people who have said something in depositions about a celebrity to change their testimony. That's illegal, but in Hollywood, it's like there are no laws. The rules do not apply.
Some celebrities even have access to a special kind of expert most people don't even know exists. Wendy Feldman is a member of a secret society of professionals known as alternative sentencing consultants. When attorneys get stars out of trouble, she helps them stay out of trouble.
They'll be called in to coach somebody out of legal trouble or from creating more legal trouble. And I call that an incarcervention. And that's a word I trademarked, and it really just means a legal intervention. Whether today it's a DUI and tomorrow it's shoplifting, and then the next day it's tax fraud. Celebrities have a habit of pushing the limits, and their entitlement makes that even harder because they're used to getting away with things. I had a case last year with a very major celebrity. She was charged with something that she shouldn't have been charged with, and we got the charge dropped, but had she not had the resources to get together the right team, she'd be sitting in jail right now.
If the public knew what some of their favorite actors were like in real life, they would not want to ever turn their movies on again.
I've never felt that the playing field of the criminal justice system is fair and flat. It's flat and fair for some people, but it's very hilly with some big pits for a lot of others.
A celebrity who's in trouble will do almost anything to stay out of the news. But perhaps even more surprising is how often the bad press is all part of the plan. Coming up.
I don't know what some of these people get paid to crash some of these expensive cars, but the more accidents a celebrity can have in a Bentley, the better it is for that brand to see, look, celebrity so-and-so, they wrecked one of our cars.
People would actually be shocked at what lengths celebrities go to stay in the news.
On July 25th, 2012, Lindsay Lohan made international headlines when she rear-ended a Mustang with her Porsche Panamera. Although there's no reason to believe this wasn't a legitimate fender bender, rumors abound that some Hollywood stars have purposely staged accidents as part of a highly secretive but very lucrative practice called celebrity product placement.
Big smile, good.
I don't know what some of these people get paid to crash some of these expensive cars. The more accidents a celebrity can have in a Bentley, the better it is for that brand to see, look, celebrity so-and-so wrecked one of our cars. They don't care, as long as the name is out there. It's all about the money, and it's all about the attention you can bring to a subject. And that's what a PR person does, either bringing attention to the subject or diverting attention from the subject.
You see pictures on Getty and Wire Image or Us Weekly or whatever, and very often you'll see a really big actor at the opening of a clothing store or something, and you think, why would he be there? Well, he was probably paid $30,000 and the publicists are negotiating that. I've never personally taken money from that, but there are a lot out there that take cuts out of it or whatever it is.
PR people are seen escorting their clients down the red carpet and talking to the press. But behind the scenes, the Hollywood publicity machine is a powerful force capable of manipulating the media itself.
The sexiest man alive. It's not a vote. It's not a bunch of editors sitting around deciding who's the sexiest person. It doesn't matter who is actually the sexiest man alive. It matters who has the best publicist. And that's something people need to realize. They're not always getting the truth, the real truth.
Celebrities are well aware of just how far their fame can get them. And an important rule to live by is always stay in the spotlight. As they say, there's no such thing as bad press. And most people outside of Hollywood might be shocked to discover how often stars get caught on camera on purpose.
They're their own tip sheet. And the reason that they might tip themselves out to the public is it gets really scary for a celebrity to not be in the limelight. So you might call the media and tip them off, or you might tell your friend to call the media and tip them off. More often than not, sources at rehabs or sources in jail on celebrities are created by the celebrity themselves.
Every once in a while, you'll see a celebrity play out their dirty laundry to the press at a nightclub. You'll see somebody in a tumultuous relationship show up at your club and leave out the front door when normally they want to leave out the back door. And then the next day you'll see in TMZ or on E, this so-and-so is spotted with a mystery blonde, and then they got a picture of the ex-boyfriend getting mad.
People would actually be shocked at what lengths celebrities go to stay in the news. Whether it's wearing the same outfit as another celebrity so that they can appear in the Who Wore It Better commentary, or whether it's to date a new person just to remain relevant, because being relevant means that you get work.
Very few people are famous in the way that I think most people assume fame works. There's probably like a dozen people at any time who are Kim Kardashian famous, Lindsay Lohan famous, where if you go outside, there's gonna be paparazzi. If you're not one of those 12 people, you have to kind of find the paparazzi. You have to go to one of 10 places. You have to go to the Ivy, you have to go to one of 6 nightclubs.
The Hollywood publicity machine doesn't just support celebs. It also influences which films win awards.
There are PR campaigns that can be done to help actors and films garnish award nominations within all of the award shows. And I don't think the public would ever be aware. I don't even know if the public really even knows about the actual nomination processes within each award show. They're almost secret societies within all of the different organizations that handle the nominations. And there's probably a lot that I don't even know as a publicist because it goes on with executives.
The campaigns for the Oscar ratchet up every year and they're really serious. They're almost like on the level of political campaigns.
Whether it's campaigning for awards, making a scene at the right club, or even orchestrating a car crash, celebrities are always finding ways to stay in the spotlight. But could there be an even higher power in Hollywood than the publicity machine? Does divine inspiration exist in Tinseltown? Or is the bottom line Hollywood's only Bible? Coming up.
Not only was it okay to use sex to bring people into the organization, but it actually was a good deed because you're converting someone to Christ.
Hollywood is like Sodom and Gomorrah with valet parking.
Hollywood is considered by many to be the most decadent place on earth.
Hollywood is like Sodom and Gomorrah with valet parking.
But in a town famous for its flagrant immorality and celebration of sin, some people might be surprised to know that conservative religious institutions have more influence than any other outside groups.
Christianity is big business. They own media empires. They own publishing empires. They are very, very big, and billions of dollars go into Christian programming and even movies. Mel Gibson's movies make hundreds of millions of dollars because Christians are as devout to the kind of entertainment that's put before them as they are to the doctrine that is handed to them every Sunday in church.
Most people in Hollywood are not outwardly religious. And in contrast, many people in America are very religious. So what you'll often see studios do is try and figure out how to make their movie more attractive to a particular religious community. It's not in order to convert people, it's in order to make more money, which is ultimately the real religion of Hollywood.
Religious themes can be found in nearly any movie, but sometimes the studios will secretly go out of their way to make sure a blockbuster caters to a Christian audience.
With Man of Steel, Warner Brothers attempted to court a Christian movie-going audience, and they did that by offering early screenings to pastors, making some suggestions about scripture that relates to the movie, and generally sort of emphasizing themes that they felt were Christian in Man of Steel. It's actually not that unusual. Another movie where that was done recently is The Butler. There's even a totally different trailer for that movie, which has gospel music playing, and Oprah uses the word God, which is different from the one most people saw.
Denzel Washington, Mel Gibson, and Martin Sheen are just a few A-listers who are known to be devout Christians. But many in the entertainment business find themselves drawn in by more secretive and less mainstream religions.
Los Angeles is the best place to start a new religion. The way things happen here is they happen in private ceremonies, parties. So you meet people who want to take you into this place where there's some juice, there's some power, there's some wisdom.
With megastars like Madonna, Gwyneth Paltrow, Britney Spears, Paris Hilton, Ashton Kutcher, and Demi Moore all having joined its ranks at one time or another, a previously secret Jewish mysticism has gained a powerful following in Hollywood, Kabbalah.
It's a little-known, esoteric, ancient organization that teaches how to get in tune with the divine, how to really get in touch with God so that you can achieve your own levels of success that these celebrities so desire. How to, in a sense, become a god yourself.
Though Kabbalah is based on Jewish principles, some of the practices of its members, like holding cleansing dinners, wearing red string bracelets to ward off evil, and reading books written only in Aramaic, have raised eyebrows. Another religion that's gained an even bigger following in Hollywood and is even more secretive is the Church of Scientology. How has Scientology gained such a substantial A-list following? And why is the media so afraid to talk about this secret society?
Everybody was afraid. It's this secret celebrity club, but they have some really famous and powerful members. So we're not going to touch them because we don't want to jeopardize our relationship with those famous members. What are they doing in there? Why are these minions marching around Hollywood in sailor outfits? Is it a cult?
Scientology is one of the most fascinating things in Hollywood because there are so many celebrities involved and executives and writers and directors and producers that we don't know about and you don't hear about. And the little bits and pieces that ever come out seem to kind of go away and get squashed so quickly. That, I think, to me is what's most fascinating. There's an idea in Hollywood that you become a member because they hide things for you or help keep it out of the media.
The Church of Scientology is recognized in the United States and other countries as a legitimate religious organization. But Hollywood has also proven to be a breeding ground for many underground fringe religions, like the Children of God.
Children of God started in 1968 in Huntington Beach, California. Reverend Dave Berg starts preaching at this coffee shop, and it's kind of this like groovy hippie preacher. One day, Berg devised this plan called flirty fishing. Flirty fishing said that not only was it okay to use sex and sexuality to bring people into the organization, but it actually was a good thing. It was a good deed because you're converting someone to Christ. So imagine you're a Hollywood screenwriter, you're at a party in these hills, and all of a sudden you're being talked up by three beautiful young women. You find yourself in bed with them, and they ask you at that very particular moment if you take Jesus into your heart. And many did. Even today, we know a lot of young people who are on the rise as movie stars and recording artists and TV stars who grew up in that group.
The Children of God is still around today under a new name, the Family International. And it's only one of many fringe religious organizations in Hollywood.
There are a lot of secret societies in Hollywood. You know, what you see from the outside is only the tip of the iceberg. But, you know, it goes deep. You see satanic rituals happening. You hear about them from friends. There are culty organizations springing up left and right. This is not an easy place. It can be very isolated. People join up with organizations that may not be beneficial for them.
With Hollywood's social and political influence, how concerned should we be?